to day five of Capital One Bowl Mania. And we start our coverage today from the west bank of the Red River in northwest Louisiana for the 34th Walk-Ons Independence Bowl, the fifth meeting all time between Miami and Louisiana Tech. And if the first 4 days of Capital One Bowl Mania are any indication, we're headed for a wild ride today.
And he is in the end zone. Fires, intercepted. Jones running left side is in.
Throwing to the end zone, caught. And the pressure gets home on Eason.
Johnston has a man in the end zone. Lunging for it is Hayden Pittman.
And it's picked off. That'll do it.
Guys have just lifted me up, and I know Wendy is smiling down on all of us right now.
You're watching Capital One Bowl Mania.
So Independence Stadium in Shreveport, Louisiana, the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. Miami is here from the ACC in the Coastal Division at 6-6 overall. Louisiana Tech, not a far drive down I-20 from Ruston, where the Bulldogs went 9-3 and 6-2 in the Western Division of Conference USA. We welcome you upstairs. Great to be with Roddy Jones, Wes Durham, Eric Woods, our field analyst. You'll meet him in just a moment. The same question gets asked year after year at bowl season. Who wants to be there? Who's kind of looking ahead? Is this part of 2019 or is this part of 2020? We're going to find out for both schools today.
We certainly will. And the motivation question is a big one in this game. As you mentioned, Ruston only 100 miles from Shreveport. It's thought to largely be a Louisiana Tech heavy crowd today, and they're excited to play against an ACC school, one of the premier brands in all of college football. On the other side for Miami, seven players not playing in this game for various reasons. They've had a disappointing season at 6-6, finished it with two straight losses. So are they motivated to come out here and propel themselves into 2020 with a win?
We know one guy that will be motivated today, the ACC Defensive Rookie of the Year, Gregory Rousseau.
He has been absolutely fantastic this season. After not playing due to injury last year, he burst onto the scene. 14 sacks on the season, tied for second in the entire country, and he can do it in a litany of ways. He's got great length, great explosiveness, has been one of the dominant defensive forces in all of college football this year, Wes. And with Chase Young likely going to the NFL, the Ohio State defensive end, Gregory Rousseau may very well be the premier pass rusher in all of college football next year.
Well, Rousseau will have to be interested because he's going to get one of the most explosive offenses in Conference USA, Roddy, with Jamar Smith at the wheel.
Yeah, this Louisiana Tech offense has been incredibly explosive, as you said. Jamar Smith, the Conference USA Offensive Player of the Year, can do it all. But he's not the only one. Justin Henderson, the running back, is 33 yards from 1,000. He's got three receivers over 500 yards receiving on the season and another one at 488. He's also got an offensive line with three fifth-year seniors, two fourth-year juniors, incredibly experienced, and that's why they've been incredibly consistent this year out of Conference USA.
Well, the Bulldogs are here despite losing two of their last three with nine wins. And when we come back, Eric Wood tells us about a game time decision for the Canes. We welcome you back to Shreveport, the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl with Miami and Louisiana Tech meeting for the first time in 15 years. Our field analyst is Eric Wood. And E. Wood, to be honest with you, Miami has been dealing with a question a lot in the couple of weeks leading up to this kick.
Yeah, when we talked to head coach Manny Diaz about their up and down season this season, he cited the quarterback play. Jaren Williams, number 15, will likely start for the Hurricanes today, but we could also see number 5, Nikosi Perry. He was 2-1 this season as a starter. They also have on their roster Ohio State transfer Tate Martell, who's the former high school national player of the year.
All right, so Jaren Williams will get the start for Miami, and the Canes are going to get the ball first. Mike Harley and K.J. Osborne will be deep. And Osborne averaged 20 and a half yards of return on just 9 kick returns during the course of the year. You look at Bailey Hale for Louisiana Tech, senior from Iowa Park, Texas. It'll kick it away for Skip Holtz and the Bulldogs. And away we go from Shreveport. And this will be Osborne at the 7. And a high kick. And K.J. Osborne will get to about the 23-yard line. And that's where we'll get a look at an offense, Roddy, that was under 400 yards a ball game. In fact, 11th in the ACC and 90th overall was Miami at the end of regular season play.
Yeah, and a lot of the offensive numbers are skewed by the fact that they are a slower offense, but they have not been great by any stretch of the imagination. Really struggled on third downs and in the red zone, and it all starts with the quarterback, Jaren Williams, who at times has been really good for them, but the consistency has been a big issue.
Because of the injury to DJ Dallas, Cameron Harris is the running back, and he'll get the carry on first down. At about 3 for Harris before he's pulled down by Alex Zaid, the linebacker. He'll play with Connor Taylor because Colin Scott, one of their leading tacklers, is ineligible for the first half due to a targeting call in the final minute of their regular season finale against Texas San Antonio in Conference USA play. Second and 7. The catch to Osborne, and he'll have the Miami first down. He got dumped over out of bounds by Michael Sam, the corner. K.J. Osborne, 46 catches now in the season, averaged about 4 a game.
Yeah, and he'll be facing a Louisiana Tech team that is missing its best player, Amik Robinson, the corner, number 21, deciding to forego this game. Was banged up coming into it, decided to forego this game to focus on draft prep. So it'll be interesting to see how they perform against this Miami wide receiving core.
Here's his throw, quick slant, and that's Harley. And boy, he got tagged by Snead, the safety. Second team All-Conference USA, Legarius Snead. Blasted, he's the leading tackler for this team too.
Yeah, Legarius Snead, a guy that is not afraid to come up and lay the wood. You see it there, breaking on the football, being able to contact the receiver. He's going to be involved a lot today. As you said, one of the leading tacklers on this team likes to stick his nose in there and get in the action.
Yep. So second down and 10. Here is Harris, and he'll slip through for about 3 yards on the play. Cameron Harris, Robert Burns handled the load running the ball for Miami after the injury to DJ Dallas.
This is where Miami has struggled the most this season. This is the worst team in the entirety of college football. 130th of 130 on third downs at 26.4%. So what does Dan Enos draw up here to try and pick up their first one?
Roddy, they were 5 of their last 29 to close the regular season. Williams from the pocket, and the ball got batted away on a pass intended for Harley. And out of the secondary, James Jackson, the outside linebacker who had a pick six against UT San Antonio in their regular season finale.
Well, they go with man-to-man, and Jackson just able to stay step-for-step with Harley on a little over route. And it's a really nice job by this Louisiana Tech defense of holding up on a third and long. Again, the struggles for Miami continue.
23rd best punter in the country, the Aussie Lou Headley. Redshirt sophomore to punt it to Smoke Harris. Rugby style kick. And here is Harris at the 11. And Smoke Harris up the far side and banged out of bounds near the 30. And that's where we'll get a look at Skip Holtz and his offensive coordinator Todd Fitch in this explosive Louisiana Tech offense. 50-yard punt by Headley. And here is Jamar Smith, a senior from Meridian, Mississippi, the Conference USA Offensive Player of the Year, making his 38th career start today.
And it's funny, when we talked to offensive coordinator Todd Fitch and asked him about Smith's ability to take care of the football, only 4 interceptions this season, he said that's not even fair. 2 of those interceptions were tips. Only 2 of them are really bad decisions. Incredible command of this offense.
Abear, the tight end in motion. Here is Smith on first down, the throw and the catch. And stepping away is Malik Stanley down the far sideline for the Bulldogs near the Miami 32. Romeo Finley pulls him out of bounds, but Smith goes to one of his valuable wideouts on the first snap.
Well, it's just the slant, and it looked like Al Blades on the coverage just tried to undercut it and knock that ball down, but it was Stanley that was able to come up with the catch, a missed tackle, and he's off to the races. Big play to start for Louisiana Tech.
An excited partisan Bulldog crowd, and a sack now of Smith is coming back around. It looked like Is that Scott Patchen? It was. The backup at one of the defensive end spots, but because Jonathan Garvin and Trayvon Hill have opted to start their professional career, Scott Patchen gets another chance here, and that's his second sack of the year.
And Scott Patchen's a guy that started a lot for Miami this season, actually moved to the bench when Gregory Rousseau started to emerge. So he's a starter, has played a lot for this Miami team.
Second and long after the sack. Smith flips to Henderson. Marker down on the play. And Al Blades makes the stop over in front of the Louisiana Tech bench.
Guys, we're going to get a chop block up front. Greg Rousseau made an inside move and stalwart the right tackle for Louisiana Tech, a really good right tackle. He cut him as the running back was coming up to make contact with him.
Scott Campbell is from the Big
12. Chop block, number 65, 77. Offense, 15-yard penalty. Still stick it down.
That'll take the Bulldogs back even more.
Yeah, and Eric, you absolutely nailed it. Gregory Rousseau to the bottom of your screen. He's going to make an inside move. Got one guy going low. Looked like the guard, Ethan Reed, kind of hit him up high. I actually think that's a little unfair. It didn't look like Reed was trying to contact Rousseau, but it looks bad. Refs are going to call it. And now Louisiana Tech's got second in a country mile.
Well, it dulls the momentum of the play from the Smith to Stanley to start the ball game. See how Skip Holtz's team recovers. Smith wants to throw and overshoots the intended receiver. That's Adrian Hardy, junior from Houston. Roddy, you made the point. He's got three receivers over 500 yards, a fourth one in the neighborhood. It's not just a single threat that Louisiana Tech has, and that's why they're so explosive offensively.
That's why they're so dangerous. All of these guys are counted on by Jamar Smith.
Griffin Hebert, 28 catches, and there's a ball pop loose after Smith was sacked. But he's going to be sacked on the play, and that's Rousseau getting to the quarterback for the first time today. So Patchen won and Rousseau won, and Louisiana Tech backed up after the first play from scrimmage. And Miami got a couple sacks to their credit, a loss of nine there.
And this is something we talked to Todd Fitch about this week. Miami's defensive ends have been a handful for everybody around the ACC this year. And Todd Fitch said they're going to have to get rid of the ball quickly, mix up protections, and sitting there in third and extremely long is not a place they would need to be in.
Osborne will wait on the punt here from Brady Farlow. And it will hit short and take a Louisiana Tech bounce and continue to roll down around the Miami 11-yard line. So Farlow and the Bulldogs punted deep into Miami territory, 51 yards, and no score yet at the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl.
Want to stay up to date? Hey Siri, what bowl games are coming up?
Coming up tonight, 8 Eastern on ESPN, we'll send you to Ford Field for the Quick Lane Bowl. Mike Corey, Rini Ngolia, Allison Williams standing by to see if Pittsburgh can win a postseason game for the first time since 2013. Their last win, by the way, Roddy, in Detroit. Meanwhile, Chris Creighton has done a marvelous job in the MAC at Eastern Michigan, making their third bowl trip in 4 years. And you'll get a look at the first-team All-America tackle, Jalen Twyman.
Jalen Twyman's been a big reason why this Pitt team has been one of the best teams at getting after the quarterback all season.
First down, Harris the back. Williams wants to throw, and Osborne wide open shy of the 30. Already K.J. Osborne's found himself available for Jaron Williams. Tackle made by the corner, Sam.
It's the second time they've gone to that deep out to K.J. Osborne, and Michael Sam is giving K.J. Osborne a lot of cushion. This Louisiana Tech defense not wanting Miami receivers to get behind him, but that's a throw that Jaron Williams should take all day.
And we got some movement. I think it's tight end Mallory that might have been guilty.
Well, start, number 88, offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
It's on the tight end, Polendi. Manny Diaz with Brevin Jordan injured and not dressed today. Miami's had to dip into their depth, and Will Mallory had an incredibly strong finish to the regular season. Here's Harris on the first down play after the penalty, getting a couple yards back. So second down coming up.
on that last offsides, it's going to be something interesting to watch today. Louisiana Tech, when they line up on defense, they're generally in a three down front. They'll have three defensive linemen. But when they want to get to a four-man front, they'll often shift right before the snap. That could be really hard, especially with all the Louisiana Tech fans cheering while they're on defense. It can be very hard, especially for the tackles and tight ends to stay on sides.
It's kind of a pistol set for Williams on second down. Pressure coming, got rid of it in time. And here's Parrott, the fullback, sneaking out into space. How about that? Rare catch of the ball, just the second catch of the year for Michael Parrott out of Western North Carolina up in Canton, North Carolina, and Ezekiel Barnett made the tackle.
It's a nice job of Jared Williams showing poise in the pocket. Louisiana Tech able to get some pressure, but knows where his check down is, delivers an accurate throw, and that's something that Jared Williams has done really well when he's been good this year. It's poise in the pocket, his ability to deliver, setting up a third and short.
Three receivers and the tight end Mallory here in the set. Harris in the backfield with Jaron Williams. That's Osborne drifting back, and they'll hand it to KJ Osborne. And he got the first down number. So Miami continues the drive on the little sweep to KJ Osborne, Roddy.
Well, it's a nice little wrinkle getting K.J. Osborne, who's their punt returner, kick returner, in the backfield. Watch the block by Cameron Harris on the edge. He's able to set it. Osborne's able to get around and get enough for the first down. It's a great job by the offensive line. A nice block by the running back to pick that up.
So fresh set of downs for Miami on their second possession, and the redshirt freshman Jaron Williams to work. This is Harris again looking for some room. Picks up about half of it on first down. Running behind Zion Nelson, the true freshman at tackle. Remember, Navon Donaldson, the left guard, not playing today because of a lower leg injury sustained back during the course of the end of the regular season. John Campbell, a redshirt freshman, is in there now playing at the left guard spot. So you swap 6'6", 345 for 6'5", 310.
And John Campbell, a guy who's played a lot over the course of the season, actually started the season at right tackle against Florida, but because of some issues on the offensive line, they've switched that around.
Williams trying to flip it short again. That was Harris, the intended receiver, and he never got on balance. So all of a sudden, it's third down for Miami.
Miami goes to the screen there. They will run a number of screens throughout this ball game. They will run them to the tight ends, the halfbacks. They will run them from about everywhere. And the reason is because when you have an offensive line that is as young as theirs and that has struggled at times this season, you will protect them with the screen game.
Yeah, and Bob Diaco, the defensive coordinator for Louisiana Tech, told us that's something that they're worried about. And they had it set up pretty well there for a decent game.
Robert Burns is coming the ball game with Williams now on third down. Williams will keep it and be close to the first down. Milton Williams, the defensive end, Louisiana Tech sack leader, makes the stop for the Bulldogs.
Whether he gets it or not, I think this is a great play by Jaron Williams, making a quick decision, not liking what he's seeing, and just taking off, getting north, trying to get that first down, because it sets him up in a situation where they've got a decision to make, if nothing else. Whether or not they get this, it's a really nice decision by Jaron Williams, and if I'm Miami, I think I go for it.
Right. And Scott Campbell and this Big 12 crew want to bring the chains from the far side here at Independence Stadium. They're going to pull the chain short before, and it's going to be what? Couple links or so.
Yeah, and Jaron Williams is running back out onto the field.
Well, Miami's going to go for it. And Roddy brings up an interesting, about an hour and a half before the game today, Tim Reynolds of the Associated Press sent a tweet out saying that this could possibly be the final ball game for the offensive coordinator Dan Enos on Manny Diaz's staff. Miami did not want to offer a comment, by the way, on the story, but barring a significant change in plans, they're expected to part ways, according to Tim Reynolds.
Well, there was a lot of talk about whether or not this would happen coming into this week. Questions surrounding this program.
Right.
Dan Enos has been asked a number of questions about the performance of the offense, and certainly he's not happy with it. As they review the spot here, certainly he's not happy with it. But the fact that you're last in the country on third downs, you're one of the worst in the red zone, it's going to raise some questions about the effectiveness and also the inconsistency of the quarterback play, the position that Dan Enos coaches.
Right.
Yeah, and when you look at the other side of the ball, how well Miami's defense has performed this year, second in the conference, only giving up 20 points a game. But when you look at a season, very disappointing from Miami Hurricane football standards at 6-6. There is going to be a lot of blame passed to the other side of the football, and a lot of that falls on Dan Enos.
Well, the other part, too, is Scott Campbell is on the headset, and they're discussing, I think, with the folks upstairs here in the replay booth, the spot of the ball. The other thing is, you never could build confidence with that side of the ball during the year. Eric, we saw the great effort against Louisville offensively, put up a huge number of points against the Cards, and then gave it back with losses to Florida International and Duke to close the regular season.
With the ball at the 48-and-a-half-yard line, which is enough for a first down. Game clock operator.
So now, after review,
game clock,
first down's
awarded. 7 minutes, 28 seconds.
You still want to show it?
And some of the Bulldog partisans here in Shreveport will not like that. Nonetheless, Miami's drive is alive.
Yeah, and I like the aggressiveness that Manny Diaz looked like he was about to show by going for it. But, again, it goes back to the decision by Jaren Williams. Doesn't like what he sees from his first two receivers. Takes off, picks up the first down.
They're looking for a little maintenance on the timing. So they're looking for the game clock back to 7:28. And first and 10 coming up for Miami. Williams will keep it again. And knocked down right at the midfield stripe. Bulldogs stayed home that time with Jackson. The redshirt freshman sticking his nose in there, DJ Jackson.
That was a really nice play by Alex Ayeed. Right up the middle. Jaren Williams on the quarterback draw, the straight draw. He's able to beat the block, tackle the quarterback. Really nice play.
Williams, a straight drop. And overshoots Osborne, incomplete. Sam in coverage for Louisiana Tech. Osborne's been able to find some holes early, but not that time.
Well, again, there was a lot of cushion between Sam and Osborne, and Jaren Williams just not able to make the throw. Airmails it over his head, and that's some of the inconsistencies that you've seen over the course of the season. And again, a third and long here, a situation that Miami certainly does not want to be in.
Canes 2-3, and timeout being asked for by Louisiana Tech. So we'll take it with them here in Shreveport. Third and about 9 coming up for the Canes.
The Walk-On's Independence Bowl, brought to you by Walk-On's Bistro and Bar. Game day with a taste of Louisiana. Lee Michaels Fine Jewelers and Lexus. Experience amazing.
Well, no bowl trip is complete without team challenges away from football. Trivia night in Shreveport between Louisiana Tech and Miami goes all the way to the wire before Skip Holtz's team is the victor. Now, he had to burn a timeout here a moment ago on this 3rd and 9. Wanted to make sure they had the right personnel on the field.
Yeah, they had 12 on the field initially, and then two guys ran off, leaving them with 10 right before Miami was going to snap it. So Skip Holtz calls the timeout to set them up in a situation that got the right number.
10th play of the drive, Robert Burns is coming to the backfield with Williams.
Miami has knocked on to the tight end, Will Mallory, who's to the top in that bunch formation.
Bulldogs bringing some heat for Williams. He'll flip it for Mallory, threw it just behind him, incomplete. Boy, the big tight end's been such a piece of the throw game for Miami at the close of the regular season.
And again, this is another one where Jaren Williams has the throw. Will Mallory is open on a little in route, just throws it behind him. Looked like he expected Mallory to come back down towards him, maybe on a curl, but Mallory keeps going in. Those two players not on the same page. And Miami doesn't convert on third down when they had an opportunity.
Lou Headley to punt it to Smoke Harris. Remember, Harris was able to get something going in the return off the first punt from Headley. This one's flipped over. fair catch call for, and it's going to check up around the 12 and bounce around. And Jimmy Murphy, one of the great walk-on stories in college football, will touch it up inside the 7 at the 6. 43-yard punt by Headley, and the Bulldogs will go to work at their own 7-yard line. And each of these teams, Roddy, features a guy who is set unbelievable standards in terms of just career consistency.
Well, the fact that these two guys play physical positions, a linebacker and a guard, that you'll see on the field right now as the Louisiana Tech offense takes the field, have that number of starts in your career, it's absolutely incredible. The leadership that they provided with Quarterman and Reed, and again, they have not missed a game due to injury. That's taking care of your body, that's toughness, an incredible ability to learn early, play early, and play well.
52, Eric, and that's not some running back making 52 starts.
Is that a shot there?
Like the one that works with us.
Okay, appreciate that.
Here is Henderson getting the carry, and Justin Henderson working toward 1,000 yards on the season. Off to a pretty good start with a big run there of 18. Amari Carter, the tackle for the Kings.
Henderson got an opportunity this season, largely due to injury. Jaquise Dancy, one of the guys, Israel Tucker as well, guys who have been a little banged up. So Henderson is able to take the starting running back position and really play well over the course of the season. Has run hard, gotten back to what made him a really good running back coming in, and that's running downhill, running physically.
Pistol set here for Jamar Smith. That's Harrison motion. They'll hand it to Henderson, and Romeo Finley had him wrapped up, and Henderson breaks free and chases it for 9 to the 34. So two big plays on the ground from Justin Henderson has given Louisiana Tech something to build on here.
Well, the Miami secondary has really played close on these receivers, taking away a lot of the slant throws and RPOs. So what does Louisiana Tech do? They go to the run game and having some success.
Second down and short. And Henderson's having to get the shoe put on. Smith had to wait momentarily on his running back, and now shoe is on, and Henderson's got the first down. Trajan Bandy out of the Miami secondary, honorable mention all ACC, wearing number 2 for the Canes, comes up and makes the stop on Justin Henderson from Lake Wales, Florida, and came to Ruston by way of Coffeyville Community College. But has 4 games of 100 yards or more, has 2 games, Roddy, with 3 rushing touchdowns, and 7 games with 15 or more attempts. So he is reliable for sure in what the Bulldogs want to do on the ground. And Henderson, another carry on first down, gets a yard maybe to the 42.
So far in this drive, they are relying on Henderson, and they are running behind a very experienced offensive line. 2 juniors and 3 seniors start up front for Louisiana Tech. They are all on the same page. They play well together. They have pretty good size, tons of starts between them, lots of all-conference accolades. This offensive line has been a huge reason why they have been so dynamic on offense this season.
Israel Tucker comes in to spell Henderson, who you saw leave, and Tucker can't get going that time because Miami sorted that out. And the Canes with Naruka blowing up the play behind the line there. Loss of 4.
Eric, you mentioned that offensive line, and that was something that Miami pointed out to us as well, just the experience and the size that this Louisiana Tech offensive line brings. And they're going to need it here. Remember last time on 3rd and long, Gregory Rousseau able to get to the quarterback with a big sack. He's to the bottom of the screen, matched up against Jawite Stallworth. See if he's able to hold up, or what Louisiana Tech does in pass protection.
Here's Smith moving the pocket, wants to throw back across, and incomplete. Looking for C.J. Powell, and Miami played it well. Robert Knowles was in the neighborhood along with Amari Carter for the Canes.
There wasn't a big window to fit that ball in, but Jamar Smith did a good job of at least giving his receiver a chance. Miami with another big stop on 3rd down is. They opted to play coverage in that situation. Louisiana Tech not able to convert.
Farlow to punt it away to K.J. Osborne. Good looking punt toward Osborne, who will field it at the 19. Split the first 2 guys, headed to the far side is Osborne. K.J. needs another block, turns the corner and breaks midfield into Louisiana Tech territory. So a guy who transferred for his grad year from Buffalo has been a leader from the start at Coral Gables. K.J. Osborne gives him a huge break And Miami in plus field territory when we continue.
ESPN, home of the college football playoff.
No score yet. First quarter continues in the Walk-On's Independence Bowl, part of Capital One Bowl Mania. And Roddy, you mentioned this at the top. For one reason or another, these are the guys on the sideline today.
Yeah, and you see the top four, and as well as Amik Robertson, sitting out due to draft prep. And whether or not you like guys sitting out the bowl game, going to the next level, this is the reality that we're in. But Miami with three others that are out due to injury, so seven significant contributors for the Miami Hurricanes not playing today.
Cameron Harris starts in the backfield with Williams. And the give to Harris, and a run of almost 10 yards on first down.
Guys, and along those lines of guys sitting out of bowl games, I talked to Brandon Bean, the GM for the Buffalo Bills, about this, and he said he doesn't hold it against guys nowadays unless they're in the playoffs because so many guys are doing it. But he said if a guy is going to be a high pick and he does play, that makes him like the prospect even more. He cited specifically Josh Allen, the outside linebacker from Kentucky last year, who went in the top 10. He said when he played last year for Kentucky in the bowl game, all scouts, all GMs, all their eyes lit up and said, that's a guy we want on our team.
Second and short, and Harris will push it across for the first down. I would use Shaq Quarterman, guys, as an example in this game, right?
I think that's a great example. I mean, his running mate, the guy who he's been with for 4 years, Michael Pinckney, decides not to, and he still opts to. And this is a guy that's thought very highly of in ACC circles and nationally as a guy who's going to have a chance to get drafted. So absolutely, the leadership there. I think teams are really going to like the fact that he decided to join his brothers one last time.
Yep. And the grad transfer, K.J. Osborne, is a guy who, as we said, going to break, has been a leader since he arrived at Coral Gables. And he's here and making an impact certainly in the ball game. Williams on a little play fake and now in trouble. Has got to avoid the rush. Cannot finally break away from Milton Williams. The Bulldogs sack leader drops Jaren Williams for a loss back to the 41. So second and long coming up.
Look like a little bit of a blown protection there from Miami. Free hitter coming off the play action. And Williams does a good job of avoiding the first guy. But then Louisiana Tech able to rally and bring him down.
Connor Taylor, the linebacker, number two, fired through there. A 2x2 look for Miami now. Second and 14. Williams shoots it across the middle and just beyond the reach of D. Wiggins.
That's something that this Louisiana Tech defense does really well. When they drop into coverage, the underneath players, the linebackers, the guys who are in between the defensive backs and the defensive line do a really good job of feeling out those intermediate routes, of getting in windows and making it tough to complete those passes.
You surprised Miami's not attacking the perimeter depth more, Roddy?
I'm surprised they have not taken a shot yet. Yes, absolutely. They've got some burners on the outside. Louisiana Tech has had some teams throw the ball over their head this year.
Jaren Williams, who was fifth in the ACC in completion percentage, just three of his first nine, throwing the ball for 36 yards. And he'll go up top here, dumps it down, and this is Harris, who dropped the shoulder briefly, but then Taylor and other Bulldogs arrive to take Cameron Harris down at the 32. Darrell Lewis, number four, the safety, showed up quick after the initial hit and collision with Harris.
But Miami's treating this as four down territory. It'd be about a 50-yard field goal if they were to kick it from here. So Jaren Williams doing the wise thing, taking the check down, allowing Miami to get in a situation where they have an opportunity to go for it on fourth and semi-manageable.
Yep. Miami 13 of 25 on fourth down this year. Burns has come in as the running back. Tight end, three receivers for Williams. Louisiana Tech going to bring some pressure. Williams in trouble. Steps up in the pocket, will run with it, and pick up the first down. Second time we've seen Jaren Williams fight through. And there is a marker down back at the 35.
This is in the area of holding. That would have been a great conversion for the Miami Hurricanes. Jaren Williams making plays with his legs today is something we have not seen him do so far much this season.
Wow. John Campbell, the left guard. Negates, obviously, the first down play by Williams.
You know, it's been a little bit of that kind of season for Miami. When you have a big play and you get a free hitter off the edge, Jaren Williams does a really nice job of avoiding the pressure, picks up the first down, but a penalty on that young offensive line ends up costing you, setting up a fourth and really long, fourth and 20, and they're going to go ahead and punt.
Yep.
But for Miami this year, it's been one thing after another. When the defense has played well, the offense hasn't necessarily played well. When the offensive line's played well, the backs and receivers haven't played well, and certainly the quarterback position has been inconsistent. So we will see a punt for Miami when we come back from the walk-ons Independence Bowl.
We go to quarter number two, walk-ons Independence Bowl. We welcome you to Northwest Louisiana with Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, Chris Tamiani, our producer, Chuck Ciccarello's our director, our great college football crew. Pleased to be here for this event that started in 1976, Roddy.
Yeah.
Thus the name, Independence Bowl.
Yeah. There you go.
Art Carmody, the executive director, has done a fabulous job and appreciate the hospitality we've been extended here in Shreveport, Bossier City. Lou Headley will punt it for Miami in a scoreless first quarter. Start quarter two with Smoke Harris standing at the eight. And Headley's rugby kick. That was close to getting picked off, and Harris signals for the fair catch inside the 10. So that's where the Bulldogs are going to start. Well, all year long, we've been following the top players in college football through the PlayStation Player Impact Ratings. And here's our top player today, Justin Henderson, the running back from Lake Wales, Florida, Roddy.
Yeah, this is 91 player impact rating. He's the fifth highest among FBS running backs. That's all running backs across the entire country. He's been absolutely fantastic. Helps Jamar Smith a ton as well. Jamar Smith's quarterback rating a ton higher with Justin Henderson on the field. So congratulations to that young man. And he's already had a couple big runs here today.
Sure has. So Jamar Smith, in his 38th and final start as the Bulldogs quarterback, slings it to the perimeter here on first down, and the catch made by Adrian Hardy. Up near the 20-yard line, that'll be close to another first down.
This Miami defense has done a really nice job of keeping Jamar Smith from getting into a rhythm, taking away some of those short throws that have made him so successful over the course of the season.
Second and a step for La Tech. Henderson got the football, and I tell you what, I'm not sure he got much because Scott Patchett had him wrapped up almost from the point of the give from Smith. And it's going to be third down. Good play by Patchett. And, of course, Shaq Quarterman as well.
Excellent play. Maybe not the dynamic pass rusher that Jonathan Garvin is or Trayvon Hill, but a really good run defender.
Now the Henderson will pick up the first down, crashing over the 20. So Louisiana Tech keeps it going in a little post-whiffle skirmish with Willie Allen at left tackle.
More of like a frog splash on the pile. I kind of like it.
Yeah, of course you would.
If I'm a defensive lineman, though, I'm not messing with 6'6", 343 after the play. I'm letting that go.
Here's Henderson breaking through that first level, and then Al Blades upends him at the 33. But another big run for Justin Henderson of 12 yards. And all of a sudden, you sense that 33 for the Bulldogs is getting some rhythm here in the run game.
And it's going to allow Jamar Smith to be able to get some rhythm on the outside as well. But it starts with the run game here today.
Henderson again. And offensive coordinator Todd Fitch just content to hammer away right in the middle of Miami's defensive front. Quarterman makes the stop on Henderson after a gain of just a yard.
And at some point, Louisiana Tech's going to have to take a shot over the top, playing extremely tight man-to-man all across the board. Roddy, you mentioned earlier, likely to defend against the RPOs of Louisiana Tech, but at some point, they have to take a shot deep.
Harvey and Russo now the ends for Miami. And here's Henderson on the receiving end of a pass from Smith. And he'll get two more to the 36. DJ Ivy up for support from the Miami secondary.
And Shaq Quarterman down. And around the numbers, number 55, he showed 52 starts in his career. An incredible leader, has played for 4 years for Manny Diaz and this defense. be a big loss for Miami.
Yep. We got a timeout at the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl in Shreveport.
That's our third year title sponsor, Walk-Ons Independence.
Second quarter continues from the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl here in Shreveport, Louisiana. And it's third down and long for Louisiana Tech in a scoreless ball game with Miami. Jamar Smith's got Israel Tucker, the redshirt junior from Metairie, Louisiana, in the backfield with him.
A great matchup to watch on this play is Dwight Stallworth, the right tackle, against Greg Rousseau. These are two guys that could be playing on Sundays.
Here's Smith. He's going to keep it, and he will fight through and get the first down to the 44. Roddy, why so much success up the middle here for Louisiana Tech?
Well, I like the fact that they go to this. They do a really nice job of the running back being a lead blocker, the offensive lineman get a hat on a hat. And then it's just pushing down the field. The linebackers are having to tackle with arms. Shaq Quarterman, remember, out on that play after being injured the play before. So Louisiana Tech able to pick up a big first down.
Quarterman has come back in the ball game after the one snap. Smith going to dial it deep to the far side, and Harris can't come down with it. I beg your pardon, it is Wayne Toussaint against Al Blades. So the 5'9 Toussaint.
But Eric mentioned it earlier, Louisiana Tech has to take a shot. I actually thought Griffin Hebert in the slot may have been a better option to go to, but with safety help in the middle, Smith opts to go to the outside, just underthrew it a little bit.
So second in the full 10 for Jamar Smith. That's Tucker in motion. And they try and set up a screen, and they do, to Bobby Holly. One of the A-backs, if you will, senior from Farmerville, Louisiana, picks up his seventh catch of the year. We've seen A-backs and fullbacks used in a variety of ways here in the first half for really both schools.
Bowl season, Wes. Anything's on the table.
10th play of the drive is third and short.
Miami really stacking the box now. Looks like man-to-man coverage on the outside.
And they're going to swing it here, and this is Tucker. He'll turn the corner and pick up the first down.
You mentioned the A-back Bobby Holly on the last play. Catches the pass. That time able to get out to the perimeter, throw a really nice cut block on Romeo Finley, the striker, that sort of nickelback position for Miami. That's what allowed Henderson to get the first down.
Well, Coach Skip Holtz, his offensive coordinator Todd Fitch, is getting into some depth of their personnel on the offensive side here on this possession. And here is Henderson back in the ball game as the running back, and he'll crash down for 3, maybe 4 yards on first down. You saw Harris go in motion there. They've thrown the ball to Toussaint. You've seen Bobby Holly catch a ball out of the backfield. And I know you guys constantly tell me this is a bowl game, so you can turn the catalog wide open if you want to.
Absolutely.
Turn it open, and I'm waiting on a trick play, especially in positive territory. Once they cross the 50-yard line in a bowl game, you always have to be worried about a little bit of trickery if you're a defensive coordinator.
And try to get it to Henderson. He bounces off the first guy, and now down to the Miami 25 goes Justin Henderson. Another strong run. Gerben Hall is the guy he slipped away from, and Henderson loses his hat, but another big run of 13 yards.
One of the things you're always worried about if you're coming into a bowl game as a coach is tackling, and while they didn't have a great shot at Henderson there, looked like there was some color for Miami that could have grabbed Henderson, but able to bounce off the backs of his linemen, gets out to the perimeter, picks up a nice run.
And we got an injured Miami player as well, Scott Patchen, shaken up as you see Justin Henderson also take a break for the Bulldogs of Louisiana Tech.
And Wes, that hurts Miami if Scott Patchen is missing for any period of time from a depth standpoint. We've already mentioned two defensive ends, John Garvin and Trayvon Hill, deciding not to play in this game to prepare for the NFL draft. So Gregory Rousseau and Scott Patchen started. We'll likely see a lot more of Jafari Harvey in the game. But after that, there's not a lot of guys that have played. They may have to start moving some defensive tackles out to end.
Israel Tucker's come back in the ballgame as a running back. That's Harris in motion. Here's Smith wanting to throw. Rousseau got to him, but he cut it loose. And wide open is Tucker for the touchdown.
26 yards. Jamar Smith to the running back Israel Tucker.
What a job by Jamar Smith, keeping his eyes downfield under pressure, feeling the heat, moving up, looking like he was going to run, and then just finding his running back who leaked out of the backfield for a big completion, getting Louisiana Tech on the board. Nice job by the fifth-year senior quarterback.
13 plays, 91 yards in 5-17. A scoreless tie is broken on Jamar Smith's 18th touchdown pass of the year. Football, a game of inches.
The Walk-On's Independence Bowl, brought to you by Walk-On's Bistro and Bar. Game day with a taste of Louisiana. AT&T and Capital One, what's in your wallet?
Well, previous winners of the Walk-On's Independence Bowl, including the Cyclones of Iowa State, Jamar Smith, the veteran leader of this Louisiana Tech team, 26 yards to Israel Tucker, 7-0. As Capital One Bowl mania continues here today from Northwest Louisiana with Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, Wes Durham. Great to have you with us. Just an early pass play that was within inches of a Greg Rousseau sack.
Yeah, it certainly was. And you said it going to break. Football is a game of inches. I'm just breathing a sigh of relief that the Air Force Falcons were not on that billboard that we ran as winners of the Independence Bowl. For no reason personally that I know of. I'm just glad.
Other than your brother was on the Air Force team?
Yeah, when we played him in 2010 here. We don't talk about that, though.
Oh, me. KJ Osborne waits on the kick. And there'll be no return. Miami going to scrimmage from its 25. Let's take a look at the Bowl Challenge Cup standings brought to you by Progressive Insurance. We get a couple of ball games today. The Pac-12, obviously, with a win. Max got a couple, as does the Sun Belt and Mountain West. The Pac-12 win belongs to Washington the other night in Chris Peterson's farewell out in Vegas. Conference USA and ACC gets going. 10 teams from the Atlantic Coast Conference. Most teams from one league in postseason play this year, and the Canes getting the ACC started with Pittsburgh to follow tonight in Detroit. There's Cameron Harris trying to get the ground game going for Miami on the fourth possession of the afternoon for the Canes.
It has not solely been on Jaren Williams why they haven't scored in this game, but coming into this game, Manny Diaz said we could likely see two quarterbacks for Miami. If they do not score on this drive, it would not surprise me to see them try to either work in Nikosi Perry or Tate Martell into this game. They said this game was a bridge game into 2020. They want to evaluate what they have moving forward.
8 carries for Harris, 30 yards. He's replaced by Burns. Here's a quick throw to the perimeter, and Mark Pope works his way to about 32, so third 3 coming up for Miami. Interesting comment when you hear a coach talk about a bridge game. Roddy, time and again we've seen schools use these games, as we said at the top, to close one year. And I think that's where Louisiana Tech is today, trying to get to 10 wins for the first time since, what, 1984, right?
Yep.
Or Miami, who's talked about 2020 more than they talked about 2019.
Well, Miami is looking after a disappointing season to get some momentum going in the offseason. You look at what another ACC member did, Virginia, getting a big win in the bowl game last year, propelled them to this season.
Williams on third down, and Osborne the catch, could not complete it though, and the ball got jarred loose on the hit by Roberson.
And Wes, how many times have we seen in this game Jaren Williams not put the ball on an open receiver? We saw it with Will Mallory, we saw it with KJ Osborne. This ball is on the back hip of KJ Osborne, where he's not able to secure it before the defender gets there. That's on the quarterback. You got to deliver that ball, put it on the numbers so your receiver can secure it before he takes the hit and convert the first down.
Miami has missed their last 3 third downs. They're 2 of 6. And Headley on the punt once again for the Canes as Harris waits. Headley going to drive this toward the Miami bench on the near side. And what a collision. A flag will be thrown on the play. My heavens. Now, I think this is to Corey Crouch, the corner. Miami operates with two number 23s. The other is Cameron Harris, but I think this is on Couch
on the punt cover.
You're correct, Wes. This actually happened right in front of me. What a collision this was.
Kick catch interference. Number 24, kicking team. 15-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. First down.
This was an enormous hit that happened right in front of me. And Smoke Harris is one tough guy. He got right up, and he's only 5'6", gets right up on that hit.
So Tecori Couch unloads on Harris. And the Bulldogs will play from their 40 when we come back, and they lead 7-0. You're watching the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. And we're at Independence Stadium in Shreveport, Louisiana, 7-0. Not a long ride down I-20 for Skip Holtz, who 55-36 in 7 years, 5 consecutive bowl wins. But, Roddy, this is the 7th time in his coaching career his team has won 9 or more in a season.
It's impressive. And this team going for 10 wins. The 5 consecutive bowl wins, that's a trivia question that you could get a lot of people on around college football.
Well, you're right about that. Tied with the Wisconsin Badgers entering this postseason campaign. Henderson again. Crossing play, Quarterman the tackle. After a gain of almost 3 on first down. Really like the way Justin Henderson goes about his business. 5'10", 218, redshirt junior. Second team All-Conference USA. 7th in that conference in rushing at just under 81 yards a game. He also caught 21 passes during the year. That's Harris in motion. Smith under duress, tries to flip it out in the flat. That ball got deflected around and almost picked. Scott Patchen, I think, got a hand on it. And Jonathan Ford came within a whisker of a big man interception.
It's a pretty nice snag off the turf by Jonathan Ford. Louisiana Tech opting to go fast here, trying to catch Miami off guard.
Yep. So third down, and now, boy, Skip Holtz not happy at all with the slow spotting of the football by this Big 12 crew. Smith wanted to check back. Rousseau pressures, and Smith will throw it over Henderson's head, incomplete. That's well done by Miami defensively. Ronnie, they muddy the water enough there on Smith?
Yeah, they did, and they got a couple of free rushers on the edge that Louisiana Tech couldn't account for. It looked like Jamar Smith expected Henderson to keep going out towards the flat, didn't do it, but Skip Holtz is visibly upset, obviously, with the officials. The officials spotted the ball and then had to go in and re-spot the ball when Louisiana Tech was ready to go. So you can see why Skip Holtz would be upset.
First three and out of the day for Miami's defense. Halfway through period two, and K.J. Osborne waits on the punt of Farlow. Ball a hit at the 20, and Osborne going to field it on the hop, and a lot of white shirts crowding him. And no place to hide for K.J. Osborne and move it back upfield. Miami starts inside its own 10, trailing Louisiana Tech 7-0. We welcome you back to Shreveport. And apparently the speculation and the reports of bowl practice are true, Roddy Jones, because here comes Tate Martell out of Bishop Gorman in Las Vegas to play quarterback for Manny Diaz.
Well, other schools around the country have had success with Ohio State transfer quarterbacks, so Miami trying to find some of it here. Former five-star recruit, Gatorade National Player of the Season, took a little bit of time off at the end of the year to get his head right, but Manny Diaz and Dan Enos opting to go with Martell to start this drive.
His only statistics, 2 carries for 2 yards in game 1 against Florida. And here he is at quarterback. And no surprise, Martell will run with the ball on first down and pick up almost 6.
And honestly, Wes, Miami's had the most success today with Jaren Williams running the football. And they've had a little bit with traditional run game, but it's been mostly quarterback run that's been the most consistent for him. So why not go to the guy that does it best for you from that position? And that's Martell. Louisiana Tech has to expect a heavy, heavy dose of quarterback run.
Cameron Harris in the backfield with Tate Martell on 2nd and 4. Martell thought about the throw, eludes one, and will get back to the line of scrimmage, and he gets knocked back, so it'll be 3rd and 4.
And that looked like a pass play where there was one read and one read only. He takes a snap, looks for one guy, and then if not, takes off and runs. So the question is for Miami, what's the plan on third and medium? What's the plan for this third and four? If I'm Miami, I'm going right back to the quarterback run. I'm not sure I trust Martell enough to go through the progression and find it on a traditional pass play.
So Jaren Williams has come out on this fifth possession of the first half. Tate Martell is in. No sign of Nikosi Perry. He's over near Williams on the bench. Here's a third and four for Miami. Martell will throw, and Osborne flags it down at the 22 on a great catch. Zach Hannibal was with him, but what a grab by K.J. Osborne on a bullet from Martell.
Zach Hannibal playing the position that Amik Robinson, the All-American, usually plays. What a throw, though, by Martell. On the outside, K.J. Osborne reins it in. K.J. Osborne's covered on that play. Tate Martell threw him open, and he was able to make the catch. So a really nice job. Some good offense by Miami.
And Miami gets a first down. Kane's coming off a three and out that saw Williams come out of the game. Now two tight ends, Michael Irvin Jr. and Will Mallory with two receivers. That's Osborne in motion. Martell looking to throw. Now dances around. Here's Martell coming back to the near side. And he will get out of bounds. And maybe a loss of one on the play. Connor Taylor, the linebacker, circled the field with Tate Martell.
Well, the thing is, when he takes the snap, doesn't have his initial read, and then scrambles to the side of the field where there's no receivers. All of the routes were coming to the opposite side of the field. And then by the time he gets out there, tries to make a guy miss, ushered out of bounds. And this is Eric Wood's favorite thing, a quarterback running out of bounds behind the line of scrimmage.
We talked about this prior to the game today. We knew it was coming, and that is my least favorite thing. That goes down as a sack in the book. You cannot run out of bounds behind the line of scrimmage.
Pistol set for Martell, lost a yard, and Eric is exactly where I was getting ready to go with you, is now the offensive line is working with a guy they haven't worked with in a game all year long at quarterback. You can do all you want in the bowl prep. It's almost impossible to take this to the game clean, right?
Yeah, I mean, from a cadence standpoint, a lot of times that's where you struggle. Nowadays in college offenses, a lot of them using the clap cadence, some different types of cadences, so you avoid that. They're not running an under center offense, so he is not having to get the center exchange from Gaynor, which is going to be another thing. As long as they're calling the same plays as they normally call, it's not that big of a transition for the offensive line.
Fourth penalty, 40 yards on Miami. Here's Martell, flushed from the pocket again, and he got shoved out of bounds. And that was Baldwin, the inside linebacker, back near the 20-yard line. An interesting wrinkle for Manny Diaz and Dan Enos for sure to put a package in for Tate Martell. But again, these are the reports that were talked about in the bowl prep. And you can tell looking at the wristband, he's got the full catalog on his left arm, by the way.
Yeah, and if you're Manny Diaz and you've been so displeased with the quarterback position this year, it's just going to be an open competition in the spring. So right. Why not put Tate Martell in meaningful snaps and at least see what you've got from him at quarterback?
Third and 13. Blitz coming. Martell tries to scramble around. Got some help. And he'll be sacked this time. Ezekiel Barnett navigates the entire width of the field to take down Tate Martell. Third sack for the Bulldogs in this first half.
Well, I don't think you can say enough about the coverage by this Louisiana Tech secondary. But you see up the middle, it was Ezekiel Barnett who then retraced, gets out there with Tate Martell and is able to bring him down. Martell has got to make a decision earlier whether he's going to run or throw the ball down the field. Either way, it was going to be a tough conversion. But a nice stop by Louisiana Tech on defense. Great job by that defensive backfield.
Five plays and a punt. Here's Headley to drive it toward Harris. From the 31. Harris working to the perimeter. Midfield and into plus territory goes Smoke Harris. 7-0 Louisiana Tech with good field position and 2.5 to play in Zubin Mahinton. Oh, bless your heart. With Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, Wes Durham at Independence Stadium, Shreveport, Louisiana, the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. And from just down the way in Ruston, here's Louisiana Tech with Israel Tucker in the backfield leading 7-0. And Roddy, not only do they have a chance to put some points on the board here, they get the kick to start the second half.
This big drive for this Miami defense, who has really held up for most of the game, with the exception of that 13-play drive that Louisiana Tech has scored on. This is the situation Miami's been put in on defense over and over this year.
A 2-by-2 look, and Tucker can't. Oh, it's Smith on the keeper. Rousseau hammered Israel Tucker behind the line, and Jamar Smith picks up 5 and maybe a little more on the quarterback keep. Silvera makes the tackle for the U.
Yeah, he doesn't run a ton, talking about Jamar Smith, the quarterback, but he's a crafty runner, Wes. He's not a burner, but just slips tackles when he decides to carry it.
Second down play and misses on the throw, looking for Malik Stanley.
It's one of the first times this game where they've had the slant route available, where you've had a receiver open and just needed to make the throw, and Jamar Smith uncharacteristically misses. And to me, if you don't get it here the way your defense is playing, you probably punt the ball, so I'd expect something past the sticks for Louisiana Tech.
Smith 5 of 11 for 84 yards. That's Powell in motion for the Bulldogs. And Smith going to throw and overthrows Adrian Hardy, the wide receiver.
It was a really tight window that he was trying to throw that ball into and ended up airmailing. I thought he had a little bit better opportunity to go to C.J. Powell underneath number 81, but not able to convert. And Miami, a quick 3-and-out. So they'll have an opportunity. The question is, which quarterback do we see with about a minute 50 left when they get the ball back?
Brady Farlow will punt it away. K.J. Osborne standing at the 10. Farlow trying to keep this in play, and it will skip into the end zone, and Miami will take over with 1:49 to go, and the Canes have all three timeouts. Don't forget, it's a Capital One Bowl Mania. And coverage tomorrow starts at high noon from Annapolis. North Carolina meets Temple. Sam Howell, 35 touchdown passes for the Tar Heels, fourth all-time in ACC single season mark. Pinstripe Bowl, Wake Forest. Dave Clawson trying to win their fourth straight against Michigan State. Texas Bowl looks pretty inviting with Oklahoma State and Texas A&M. And then the Cheez-It Bowl tomorrow night. Air Force 10th bowl trip with Troy Calhoun. And the Cougs make their sixth with Mike Leach. All coming up on a busy Friday at Capital One Bowl Mania. Jaren Williams has come back in for Miami at the quarterback spot here. Off the 20 for the Canes. And Harris cannot get started. Big time play by the front. Courtney Wallace, the nose at 305 from Monroe, Louisiana, pulls Harris down after a gain of a yard. And a timeout taken by Louisiana Tech.
Well, Miami goes with the conservative approach, deciding to run the football to force Louisiana Tech to either use those timeouts or let the clock run down. But Skip Holtz wants his opportunity, wants his offense to have another opportunity to score before halftime. So the cat and mouse game starts.
And Williams, I'm trying to see if Miami wants to elect to maybe change things up too, because now with Martell introduced into the equation, Roddy, you kind of got to think, was that just a one-and-done series? Maybe with Tate Martell, or is there a little bit more to the package we didn't see?
I think in a different situation, you may have seen a little more, but the fact that it's a two-minute situation now where you're likely going to have to put the ball in the air more, you go with your best passer, and that's Jaren Williams. You were looking for a little bit of a spark with Tate Martell, and honestly, the offense did about what it would have done or what it's done with Jaren Williams.
Right.
So in this situation, you go with the passer. The question is, do you put it in the air, though? Because in an incomplete pass, the clock's going to stop, and you play right into the hands of Louisiana Tech, who only has one timeout left.
So second down and 9. Here in the final 101 seconds of this opening half. Williams tries to go to Mallory. And he got knocked down at the 26, and another timeout taken. Tristan Allen, the linebacker, hit the tight end, Will Mallory. And so Louisiana Tech uses their last timeout. Don't forget, more Capital One Bowl Mania comes up on Saturday. High noon start at Camping World Bowl Stadium, or Camping World Stadium, the Camping World Bowl, number 15, Notre Dame, and Brock Purdy in Iowa State. A couple of slingers, he and Ian Book going to work in Orlando. Notre Dame's been impressive late, defeating opponents by 30 or more. Iowa State seeking their third 8-win season for the second time in school history. This is the first meeting ever between the Irish and the Cyclones.
I love these bowl games. You have these schools that have never played each other, and anytime anybody gets a chance to play Notre Dame for the first time, it's a big deal for their school. And Miami's got a decision here. They're 3 of 8 on third down so far. Do you opt to run the ball, Louisiana Tech, with no timeouts now,
right,
to drain the clock, or you put it in the air to get the first down?
Williams looks like he wants to throw. Flush from the pocket to the far side, and Taylor will take him out shy of the first down at the 29. Really impressed with the east-west running game of these linebackers for Louisiana Tech.
They have flown around. Ezekiel Barnett, Connor Taylor have done a fantastic job. And remember, they get Colin Scott back, number 35, but there's an incredible amount of time for Jaren Williams. Instead of trying to make Taylor miss there, you got to go straight at him. Put your shoulder into him, power forward for that first down. Connor Taylor able to track him down, bring him down for a big stop. Louisiana Tech, they're going to have an opportunity with decent field position potentially.
Yeah, Miami letting the play clock go all the way down before Manny Diaz bangs the timeout. And he does call it with 43 seconds left.
Miami, first of the half.
And with Miami on offense, Jaren Williams had a ton of time on that play. Louisiana Tech has done a fantastic job of covering these Miami receivers. Only one first down in the second quarter for Miami, and that is largely because of the fact that they have played blanket coverage behind. Just done a fantastic job on these receivers.
One of the things we talked about was the ability Miami might have if Louisiana Tech could give up stuff in the middle of the field.
Yeah.
That started the ball game, but Miami's not been able to expose the Bulldogs on the perimeter at all.
And that's a little surprising to me that Miami has not at least taken a shot down the field. We've seen Louisiana Tech do it at least once. You go down the field, try and test these corners a little
bit.
Miami held up. They have not done the same thing on offense,
only
testing these corners.
Only 28 yards of offense for Miami here at quarter number two. And unfortunately, that's the same song Hurricane fans have gotten used to this fall. Headley will punt it away, and it's not going to be a very good punt. Looked like he was a little off balance when he offered, and it will bounce out of bounds near the 41 of Louisiana Tech. So without a timeout and 35 seconds left, and by the way, just a 29-yard punt for Headley. The arm talent of Jamar Smith is very good.
He's got a fantastic arm. You know, being down on the field pregame, watching him throw the ball jumps out of his hand. And you mentioned the fact that this guy was a baseball draft pick as well.
Yep.
Scouts from baseball still come out to watch him throw because his arm is so strong. So we'll see if they're able to get anything going here and if Miami opts to still play up.
Well, we'll see where the Canes line up here. Israel Tucker in the backfield. See a stacked look from Louisiana Tech. Four-man rush. Smith overthrows the intended receiver, Isaiah Graham. Transfer from TCU, the intended guy. And boy, Smith got knocked down when he cut it loose. Only 5 seconds off the clock.
The push from the Miami defensive line is what caused that. It was Scott Patchen, Gregory Rousseau being able to push the interior that Smith wasn't able to step in the throw on the reset to be able to deliver an accurate ball.
See four guys in the package for Smith. Back up in the pocket. Now we'll flip it over the head of Griffin Hebert, incomplete. And all of a sudden, 24 seconds, only 6 seconds off the clock on that snap. Jonathan Ford again, fighting up the middle to pressure Jamar Smith.
Louisiana Tech also has a lot of confidence in their kicker, Bailey Hale. He has a 51-yarder this year. He started off the season 0 for 2 against Texas, 15 of 16 the rest of the year. If they can get to around the 34, 35-yard line, spike the ball, they will attempt a field goal at the end of this half.
They got to get 10 yards.
Yeah, they're going to have to block 15 on a third and long, not something that I want to do.
Yep. Here's Smith. Quick throw and almost picked by Bandy. Trajan Bandy talking to Adrian Hardy the whole way. And now all of a sudden, it is fourth down and 21 seconds left.
And Adrian Hardy slipped at the top of this route. He goes down and actually does a really nice job of just sticking his hand out to try and knock that ball down, or else Trajan Bandy is going the other way for six. But what a job by this Miami defense. As much as we've talked about the offense really throughout the season, not helping at all, this defense, once again, being able to stand up against a really prolific offense from Louisiana Tech, and they've made Jamar Smith really uneasy in the pocket.
Three straight three and outs for the Bulldogs. Farlow punts it toward Osborne. KJ will make the catch, 15 seconds left, head back up the field. Osborne pulled down at the 27-yard line with 9 seconds left. B.J. Williamson is the guy who made the tackle for Louisiana Tech. So we set ourselves up for a throw down the field here.
No, I think this is going to be a knee. And Miami's going to take it in the locker room, regroup, and figure out who's going to play quarterback in the second half.
Williams going to put three here to the wide side, Roddy.
Miami has timeouts.
Yes, they do.
Two of them left.
9 seconds left. Here's Williams up in the pocket. The catch is Osborne out to the 49. Timeout with 2 seconds left. Manny Diaz punches it. Tackle made. By Trey Baldwin. And Miami will use the timeout. So much for your victory formation.
Yeah, exactly. Nice throw by Jaren Williams. Mm-hmm. Could be big for confidence, just seeing a completion, putting an accurate ball on the money to KJ Osborne. And now it's all right. See if you can get it to the end zone from here. Maybe Miami has a trick play, some sort of hook and ladder.
Well, Louisiana Tech, by the way, now. Remember, they get the ball to start second half. That's what brought this whole conversation into play from the start. It was the chance they had to double dip of Miami's defense, with the exception of the one drive you mentioned a moment ago. 13 plays and 91 yards in just better than 5 minutes. Bob Diaco's been pacing here in the last couple moments. Was played at Iowa for the late Hayden Fry. Shared some wonderful memories of Coach Fry with us in our visit with Bob Diaco. Well, Louisiana Tech's got guys spread out over about a 40-yard track. They will only rush three here. Williams now has to run with it. Half has expired on the clock. Cameron Harris. And then Williams put it in play. And Miami, I think, is going to fall on it to end the half. And they do, back at the 39-yard line. So the half comes to a close. Jaren Williams put that ball into play. Wow. 7-0 Louisiana Tech leads Miami at the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. Here's Zubin Mehenti and Trevor Maddich.
Welcome back to Capital One Bowl Media.
And from Shreveport, Louisiana, you're watching the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Louisiana Tech from Conference USA leads Miami of the ACC 7-0 as we get ready for the second half. Great to be with Roddy Jones, Wes Durham. Thanks for being a part of our Capital One Bowl Mania coverage from here in Northwest Louisiana. Interesting first half. We look at the stats because really it was a bit of a mud fight in the middle of the field for most of it.
That's exactly right, Wes. If you like defensive football, you've come to the right place, because the defense has dominated much of the first half. When you look at how this thing shook out in the first half, neither offense really getting much going consistently. Miami put it in neutral essentially on offense in the second quarter. Third downs have been a struggle for both teams. But the secondaries of both teams have performed really well in different ways. Miami coming up and pressing, Louisiana Tech playing a little bit more coverage, able to confuse the quarterbacks on the other side.
Bulldogs in all white going to get the kick here to start the second half. Graham and Toussaint are deep, and there'll be no return. And Louisiana Tech will start from its 25 with Jamar Smith making his final start for Skip Holtz. Fifth-year senior from Meridian, Mississippi, the Conference USA Offensive Player of the Year, 24-13 as a starter, 9-1 this year for Skip Holtz.
Louisiana Tech's got to figure out some way to get Jamar Smith going. 5 of 15 for 81 yards and one touchdown in the first half. He looks like he has not really found a rhythm in this ballgame yet.
Justin Henderson, who had 70 yards on 11 carries in the first half, is the running back and gets the first carry here of half number two. Sam Brooks, we thought the freshman from Miami Northwestern High School would play extensively in the ballgame today because of Michael Pinckney opting for the draft. And Roddy, you brought up something during the break. A lot of people forgot Zach McLeod is redshirting this year.
Yeah, Miami had three senior linebackers that all came in together, all have performed really well, but because of the fact that they've gone with two linebackers most of the year, Zach McLeod opting to redshirt to come back for another season.
Yep. Here's Smith to throw, and it's a slant, and the catch is made by Malik Stanley. And a first down for the Bulldogs out to the 43 on the big-time throw by Jamar Smith, 17 yards.
It's one of the first times I can remember that slant being open and Jamar Smith hitting his receiver in stride. Malik Stanley able to get open on that press coverage. And Smith doing a good job of delivering the football. That could be the one that starts to get him going. He's able to string a couple of them together.
Smith now 6 of 16 for 101 yards and a touchdown, of course, to Tucker. The game's only mark so far. That's Harris in motion. Smith wants to throw, flips it to Henderson. Spun away from the first tackler and scraps out a yard to the 44. And a marker down on the play. Nope, second and nine. Let's go downstairs to Eric.
I talked to Coach Diaz coming out of the half about halftime adjustments. He said offensively they just need to find a way to manufacture some points. They need to run the football better, throw and catch the ball better. I asked him about the plan with Tate Martell, and he said coming into the game, they wanted to get him some run in this game to see what they had with him. And he also, towards the end of the half, got dinged up. That's part of the reason why he did not come back in for that two-minute drill. He was being evaluated for an injury in the locker room, but they would like to get him some more action in the second half, if possible.
I saw Martell reach to his kind of rib area, Roddy, at one point, and late in that possession he had. Didn't think it was enough to, now the whistle blows, and we get a stoppage of play here.
Prior to the snap, Miami calls a timeout.
Miami called a timeout before the third down play. So the Canes will burn one of the three here. And we'll take it with them. Here in Shreveport, early second half. Louisiana Tech, a big third and eight when we come back to the walk-ons Independence Bowl. We welcome you back to the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl here in Shreveport, Louisiana. Now let's take a look at what's in store this postseason, brought to you by Macy's. Of course, we got a full slate of games coming your way. The Goodyear Cotton Bowl coming up at noon tomorrow on ABC, Notre Dame, Iowa State. And then this is all Saturday, by the way, Oklahoma, LSU, and then Clemson, Ohio State. The college football playoff semifinals, the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, and the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. Media day for all four schools, by the way. Leading into those semis on Saturday afternoon and Saturday night. Out of the timeout from Miami, Smith threw it behind the intended receiver, Stanley. And all of a sudden, the drive will come to a halt for the Bulldogs here to start the third. And that's not the way Skip Holtz wanted to go. 3 of 9 now is Louisiana Tech on third down.
And Miami's defensive ends, Patchen and Rousseau, have not always gotten to Jamar Smith, but they've been collapsing the pocket consistently. Smith, not an incredibly tall guy, 6'1", So not a guy that's going to be able to throw over offensive linemen. Miami's done a really good job of getting push in his left.
Farlow to punt it away to Osborne. And a fair catch call for and made near the 22-yard line by K.J. Osborne. Just a 35-yard punt. And that'll set Miami up with Jaron Williams coming back out, a quarterback for Manny Diaz's team. Canes in search of that spark offensively, guys.
They certainly are. This is really the offense that we've seen the past three games now, though, against FIU and against Duke. An offense that has not consistently been able to put together drives, a quarterback, no matter who's playing it, that has been inconsistent in his ability to throw the ball. And there hasn't been the run game as well. The question is, does that change in the second half?
Well, the 135 in the first half, their third lowest output of the season in terms of first half yardage, is the throw is to D. Wiggins. And that'll be enough for the first down. Roddy had 135 today in the first half. They had 130 against Florida International, 100 against Pittsburgh. Remember, and that was a game where Perry started, Williams came in and pulled it from the fire with the touchdown pass late.
Yeah, and that throw that you just saw from Williams, they had that early, the throw to the field on either a deep curl or an out because of the cushion that Michael Sam was given.
Pistol set again here for Williams. Tried to make the quick throw to the perimeter, and that got batted down by James Jackson. Jackson, who has four forced fumbles on the year and the pick six in the regular season finale against UTSA, almost got one here.
Oh man, what a fantastic read, great jump by James Jackson. The ball a little outside the frame of his body, but had it not been and had been able to get two hands on it, and there's nobody else there, so it would have been a pick six. It would have been tough, but very athletic play by James Jackson.
Tell you what, you watch the tape of Louisiana Tech defensively, he is everywhere. Second in the full 10 for Jaron Williams. The give is to Harris. And he'll crack a couple of yards to the 37.
Wes, back to your point about Miami struggling to find answers on offense. You know, for me, it's what's your identity as an offense? What is your identity? You know, they have the most sacks in the country, so their offensive line struggles, so they can't get the ball down the field. They also are 120th out of 130 in rushing the football. So neither has been effective for them this year, and that's why you see such poor production out of this Miami offense.
As you see, you got to be careful throwing it against the Bulldogs, too. Here's third and eight now for Williams. Bulldogs bringing pressure. Williams trying to get to Mallory, cannot. Jackson was in coverage. And that'll be four and a punt on the fifth play for Miami.
Louisiana Tech defense has done a really nice job on the Miami tight ends, really in coverage as a whole. They brought a little more pressure than what we've seen in the past. On third downs especially, which is what makes them one of the best third down teams in the country. They're able to mix it up, dropping numbers, bringing pressure. Miami's had no answers.
So Harris will wait on the punt of Lou Headley. And Headley drives this one to Harris. And he fumbled the ball. And it looks like Louisiana Tech has recovered it. The Bulldogs, I think, caught this on the fly with Calhoun. Broderick Calhoun, a corner, scooped up what might have been a disaster for the Bulldogs. We get a break. 7-0 in favor of Louisiana Tech. Wow. Back after this to Shreveport.
The Walk-On's Independence Bowl. Brought to you by Walk-On's Bistro and Bar. Game day with a taste of Louisiana. And NerdWallet. For all your money questions, turn to the nerds at NerdWallet.
Activities during the week here at the Walk-On's Independence Bowl with Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, Wes Durham. You see what's at stake today. Louisiana Tech trying to get their first 10-win season since the mid-80s. And Miami needs to avoid their first losing season since 2014.
And what a job Skip Holtz has done here at Louisiana Tech. Five straight bowl wins, an opportunity for their first 10-win season since joining FBS. And a team that were it not for some suspensions late in the season, may very well have been playing for a Conference USA championship.
Right. Three to the field here for Jamar Smith off the 19. And he'll push the pocket that way. Rousseau couldn't get to him. Flag down. It'll be a hold. It looked like that Cody Russey, making his 26th straight start at center, had a couple of hands on Greg Rousseau.
Number 65. Offense. Half the distance to the goal. Still first down.
ACC Defensive Rookie of the Year. Has been a handful for most opponents this year.
Yeah, you see Cody Russey getting around the edge, pulling, and also pulling the jersey of Rousseau, gets that far shoulder. And the center's not used to playing in space as much with the dancing bears that Miami has on the defensive line.
Hey. Centers are athletes too. We may not be running backs, but they are centers. As you look at the center here, Cody Russey, he's a lefty. A lefty center. Those are rare in college football. They're rare in general. But now with the spread offenses, with a majority of the snaps being shotgun, a guy that was a lefty like Russey back in the day, they would have him learn to snap right-handed to the quarterback so he could get the exchange under center well. Well, now they'll let a guy like Russey snap exclusively with his left hand throughout the game, which is very interesting to me as a former center. And I was watching on coach's film. When they get into victory formation, he'll even snap it to Smith, left under center, which is something no quarterback in the league would have let me do during my days.
They'll let him snap left-handed, but they still won't let him hold. Here is the throw and a catch to Griffin Hebert. Thought we'd see more of Hebert in the throw game today for the Bulldogs, guys. He had such a strong finish to the regular season. And in fact, Todd Fitz said he's their most surprising player really through the course of the campaign. Third and nine and a quick snap for Jamar Smith. And a misfire there, looking for Hebert with Trajan Bandy in coverage for Miami. Way offline on that off.
He really tried to fire that one in. Hebert wasn't originally open, but kind of pushed off the defender to get away from him, and Smith tried to fire it in. And sometimes when that happens, you get a little bit of an overstride, and the ball sails on you, which is what happened with Smith there.
Four of the last five possessions for Louisiana Tech have been three and out.
This Miami defense has played really well in this game.
Farlow to punt. The Bulldogs have missed their last five third down tries. Canes look like they tried to get after that. Jimmy Murphy almost got there. Here's Osborne signaling for the fair catch at the 33. Takes us to a break here in Shreveport. Louisiana Tech leads Miami 7-0. Back in Shreveport, 7-0. Louisiana Tech leads Miami at the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. Let's take a look at who's making smart decisions. Brought to you by NerdWallet. Roddy Jones.
Well, it's been the Louisiana Tech defense making smart decisions the entire game, doing a fantastic job in coverage. They've been able to get pressure on the quarterbacks due to that coverage, and their ability to pursue sideline to sideline has been incredible. And they haven't just been doing it in the pass game, Wes. They've held Miami to 55 yards rushing on 20 attempts, 2.8 yard per rush average. This Louisiana Tech defense has made all the smart decisions today.
So just under 10 minutes to go here in quarter three, and a 7-0 game in Miami, who has 149 yards of offense. Louisiana Tech only 185. Flags down and the handoff to Harris, and boy, Connor Taylor rolls right through there from his linebacking spot. I think the penalty is going to be on Miami. I think Marshall Few, one of the wide receivers, junior from Ponte Vedra, was
offside, number 90.
Oh wow!
Defense.
It's on the defensive side. 5 yard
penalty from the previous spot.
Courtney Still Wallace lined up in the neutral zone. Maybe.
Yeah, it looked like he flinched early and. I guess his helmet wasn't quite back across when the ball was snapped. And you hate when that happens for your nose guard, because the obvious thing is he's standing right over the ball. He's just got to look at the ball as you see Colin Scott, number 35, returning to this ball game.
Yeah. Scott on the year, 64 tackles, 2 for loss, 3 hurries, had six or more tackles in six of their 10 games and missed the first half from a targeting rule in their regular season finale. Here is Mark Pope getting the ball on the perimeter and pushing it up to about the 45-yard line. That'll be enough for a Miami first down. We have yet to see Miami, and even Roddy, throughout their offensive struggles this fall, you could always expect one big explosion play out of the Canes at some point. Haven't seen it at all today.
We haven't really seen them throw the ball down the field at all. And some of that's probably because they haven't been in situations where you're okay with that being an incomplete pass, giving away downs, but it's made it tough on these quarterbacks to find anything underneath.
First down give, this is Harris, and Cameron Harris about 2.5 on first down. Now credit Louisiana Tech's defense as well here. A group that came in allowing 390 yards a ball game, but none of their numbers distinguished themselves as if to say they would, you know, but they forced Miami into several stalemates here in the first half and on into this second frame.
Yeah, and in this situation, Miami has gone to the pass game over and over and over. You stop for a short run on first down. I'd like to see him start to establish some sort of rhythm sticking with the run game.
Harris in motion, Burns in the backfield, and Williams to throw. Going to take the deep shot, and this is for Osborne, who's offline. Incomplete. He was covered up by Roberson, the corner. And there's the vertical shot we were talking about.
Yeah, but it comes at the wrong time. You don't just do it at any time. This is a second and long where you take the vertical shot, maybe because you think you're going to get advantageous coverage, but you don't complete it, so now it's third and long. You take those on either a first down or a second and short where you can afford to give away that down. Every time it seems like Miami's had a short run on first down, they've gone to the pass game and it's put them in third and long situation.
And here's another one, third down and 8 for the Canes, who are 3-for-10 today on third down. Pressure coming from the Bulldogs. Williams up in the pocket, he'll be sacked. Colin Scott, first white helmet there.
Talk about a guy chomping at the bit to get in the game. Colin Scott having to sit out the opening half, comes right up the middle. Is able to be the first guy to get to Jaren Williams. Williams has made guys miss in the backfield all day long. Does it again there. But this Louisiana Tech defense once again coming up huge, dialing up a blitz on a third down.
Another 5-play drive will end in a punt. 8th punt of the day for Headley.
Lou Headley at the punt.
C.J. Powell, by the way, standing at the 11-yard line. Here's the snap, and Headley hangs this one up again on the near side. Powell makes a running catch of it, out of bounds at the 16. And that's where Louisiana Tech will get started. Don't forget, bowl season rolls on Saturday. The Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic from AT&T Stadium in Arlington. Number 17, Memphis, with Brady White. Looks to end their incredible season with a victory. They'll take on number 10, Penn State. Noon Eastern time on ESPN and the ESPN app. And, of course, Memphis guided through the regular season by Mike Norvell, the new head coach at Florida State. Against James Franklin, who's just made a move as a new offensive coordinator hired this morning.
Yeah, what a season for Memphis this year, and what is the toughest Group of Five conference in the country.
Israel Tucker in the backfield, and he'll get the ball here. Pick up about 6 on first down to the 22. Tucker comes into the ball game, 327 yards and just a couple of touchdowns. Over 640 yards behind Justin Henderson, but I like the change of pace, Roddy.
There's a little bit more explosive, a different kind of runner from Justin Henderson.
So second down and 4. Louisiana Tech trying to get something soft here offensively. They've had 3 and outs in 4 of their last 5 drives, and there's the catch, Hebert. Griffin Hebert knocked back but shy of the 40 and a first down for the Bulldogs.
Coming into this football game, Griffin Hebert was the guy that we all looked at each other and said, wow, he is impressive, and they do a really nice job of getting him open on an over route, off play action. Miami loses track of the big A-back, they call him, the big slot, and he's able to have a nice catch on first down.
Here's the handoff, and working his way back upfield again is Israel Tucker.
And when you're able to run the ball effectively on first down, that sets up a play like that on second down. Roddy, on the last drive for Miami, you mentioned they took a shot deep on second and nine. You know, Louisiana Tech at that point, they're playing off in coverage. They know you're going to try to move the ball in the field. This is a big drive for Louisiana Tech. If they can score points on this drive and make it a two-score game, they have to be confident that Miami is not going to be able to keep pace with them the rest of the game.
And the other thing Louisiana Tech did, Eric, as you mentioned, is they moved the pocket. The pocket's been collapsed by these Miami defensive ends so much.
Tucker, by the way, sneaks for another yard toward the 44. But I do agree with you, Eric. You feel like that Miami might be teetering here a little bit. The Bulldogs throw another score on the board. Would Miami, who's had a hard time generating any momentum offensively, be able to get two scores, let alone one at this point?
Yeah, and to your point, Roddy, about moving the pocket and struggling on third downs, a lot of it's been protection. Early in the game, they converted a first down by simply running a QB draw with Smith up the middle.
Third down, Smith slings it to the far side and caught in traffic. Isaiah Graham pulls it down at the midfield line against Al Blades.
This is a big-time catch by Isaiah Graham. Blades is draped all over him. It's press coverage. Smith delivers the ball. He's got to catch the ball up in the air away from Blades, and he does a really nice job of catching it with his hand, securing the football, and making sure that the catch is made. It's a big third-down conversion and a really nice job of pass protection by this Louisiana Tech offense.
Graham pulling it in. Scott Patchett shaking up on the play from Miami. It's the first time in the last six third downs that Louisiana Tech's been able to convert one.
This is the second time today that Patchett's been down on the ground. And I'll tell you what, when you have guys like Trevon Hill and Jonathan Garvin that sit out of the bowl game, guys like Patchett are getting a lot more work. They took a lot more reps during bowl prep. They're also getting a lot more reps during this game. All that fatigue, that can lead to injuries, and that's what can happen when you have guys sit out the bowl game.
So Scott Patchett will make his way off the field.
All right, guys, this is the loudest the crowd has been all day today. We have the wave going. I would have suggested this majority dog crowd, Louisiana Tech crowd, I would have suggested they started this when Miami was on offense. This snap cadence, it may even start to be an issue. Maybe they need to get this going again when Miami has the ball.
It's a pretty impressive wave. They made it a couple of times around the stands. It's a really nice job of the whichever section started it, of getting this crowd involved. They haven't had a lot to cheer for so far today, at least no points.
Justin Henderson in the backfield as Smith goes to work from midfield. And Henderson got a couple to the Miami side of the margin at the 48. So it'll be second down and eight. Shaq Quarterman, the tackle for Miami. Just 86 rushing yards so far today for Louisiana Tech, who came in at 142 and a half, but Miami has held the Bulldogs to 221 total of the 445 they average on the year.
And the wave's still going, Wes. The key to a good wave is everybody being bought in, and everybody in Independence Stadium is bought in.
Here's a reverse. Toussaint going back to the far side. Keeps his feet. 35 out of bounds, Miami 34-yard line for Wayne Toussaint. They got it in the hands of the little guy, and he can make you miss, Roddy.
We've been looking for some sort of trick play over the course of the game, and you go from one burner and Smoke Harris to the other one, and Wayne Toussaint is able to make a guy miss. That was Trajan Bandy up the sideline, gets out of bounds. Well, Louisiana Tech's cooking with grease a little bit.
Jamar Smith might have gotten away with a slight hold.
You don't call it on the quarterback.
I don't know, you call on the center, ask Eric. First and 10 in Miami territory at the 34. Henderson, hit right away. Quarterman was there, as was Sam Brooks. And I can see why Miami folks were excited about Brooks. 6'2", 210, the freshman from Northwestern High School in the Miami area. And down on the play is Ethan Reed, the Iron Man of Louisiana Tech football and the longest current streak of starts in all of FBS.
making his 53rd consecutive start today. You said Iron Man. I don't even know if Iron Man starts to describe what Ethan Reed has done. A fifth-year senior, started every game since he was a redshirt freshman, and just provided a ton of stability for this Louisiana Tech offense. And that's a big reason that this offense has been so good, is how coherent they've been up front throughout the season.
Yeah, you talk about 53 consecutive starts. The fact that they've played in the championship game for their conference two out of the last 5 years, and also the fact that they've been to bowl games all throughout of his career, that allows him to get to 53. I started every game of my career, only got to 49 because we missed bowl games my junior and senior year, and I would have never guessed that whatever crew I got put on this year, that I would not have the most consecutive starts in the crew, but Roddy Jones takes the cake on our crew.
Well, yep. My starts were broken up by one game where I had to sit out due to a wrist injury, so you may have the most consecutive.
I'll take it.
Okay. Yeah. And the good news is Ethan Reed was able to make it off the field under his own power. Second and 9. And here's Smith looking to throw again. Up in the pocket, and they got him around the shoe tops. And it looked like Rousseau again, who's been a problem for Louisiana Tech. And Rousseau is shaking up on the play and is slow to his feet following another sack of Jamar Smith.
It doesn't matter how many times you're able to complete balls down the field, Gregory Rousseau is always going to make his presence felt. It's a really good job of bending the corner around the offensive tackle, Dwight Stallworth, and is able to get to the quarterback. And when you talk about a pass rusher, what do you want? You want great twitch, you want incredible length, and you want a motor to get after the quarterback. And Gregory Rousseau at 6'6 has all of those things.
Tucker's come back into the ball game with Smith. Here's Smith going to try and keep it, and Miami's not letting him go anywhere. Shaq Quarterman's involved. Scott Patchen's involved. Gilbert Frierson also there on the play. And Miami was ready for all of that.
We talked a lot coming into this game. The media talked a lot. You and I talked about it. When we did the open for this game, was Miami going to be motivated? Shaq Quarterman is motivated in this game. This defense has been motivated in this game. This Louisiana Tech offense has moved the ball on just about everybody this year. And the defense of Miami has stood up time and time again despite the struggles on offense and the situations that the offense has put them in.
They punt it deep, and that is Osborne wearing the double number here, 84, in part because there was another number two on the field, and that was Trajan Bandy. Meanwhile, Greg Rousseau, we told you at the top, the ACC Defensive Rookie of the Year. And just to look at the body transformation, Roddy.
Just look at his arms. The guy on the left looks like he may go out on a basketball court and dunk a basketball. The guy on the right looks like he's an eater of souls off the edge. His arms are jacked. This is a guy that was 6'6", 222 in high school, played receiver, defensive end, and safety, and now one of the most feared rushers, pass rushers in the entire ACC. And with Chase Young leaving, the nation is going to be looking for someone to take the mantle as the most feared pass rusher in the country, and Greg Rousseau might be that.
First down give, Harris, maybe a yard. He got knocked back by the front of Louisiana Tech. Kevin Murphy, fifth-year senior, Westchester, Pennsylvania, transfer from UConn, and Trey Baldwin in on the stop for Skip Holtz's Bulldogs. Here's the other thing, too, Eric. By the way, Roddy and I had a chance to see Greg Rousseau at the Night of Legends at the ACC Championship game. And he's nice.
Great dude.
And soft-spoken.
He is. I got a chance to talk to him on the phone earlier this season. And you talk about that body transformation he had. I asked him about that, and he said, well, when your weight room in high school up at Coconut Creek, where he's from, when it looks like a shed, not a whole lot of guys are walking in there. And at 6'6", he probably filled up the place. So he gets to Miami and is able to put on a ton of muscle, and you got to give him a lot of credit. He has worked his tail off to put himself in this position of his career.
Delay a game on the Canes.
Offense
with 5 seconds to go in the third.
This is the goal. Still second down.
And I should say, I pushed Chase Young out of the door. He has not yet declared, but a guy that's going to be either the first or second pick in the draft, I think it's pretty safe to say he's gone. I just wanted to say, you know, we didn't miss anything.
Yeah. So Jaron Williams. And they will start the clock. And Miami, did they award Miami a timeout? I think they did.
If that's the case, Wes, Miami's only going to have one timeout in a one-score game.
Yeah, they did. They awarded Miami the timeout, so only one remaining, Roddy. And here's a look at the frustration of the Canes offense today.
I mean, it's just been one thing after another. The long drive at the beginning of the game, that 10-play drive, since then, the longest drive, only 6 plays. It's just been so inconsistent. Once you get one big play, there's something that sets you back. And going back to those timeouts, Miami can hold a timeout on defense because they had 12 guys on the field on the first third down of the second half. And now with 5 seconds left in the third quarter, you're about to get a delay of game, so you call a timeout there. It's the operational stuff as well as the on-the-field product that's made Miami Hurricanes fans so frustrated over the course of the season.
Second down and 9. Likely the final play of the third. Williams wants to cut it loose. And overthrown and intercepted. Trey Baldwin comes up with the pick. 17 straight games for Louisiana Tech.
Longest active streak in the country. And Louisiana Tech did a fantastic job of dropping coverage. Those linebackers taking away the first window that Jaren Williams was looking for Mike Harley in. So he has to reset, tries to throw it without a great base, overthrows it. Louisiana Tech's got the ball going into the fourth quarter.
My goal was never to be the quarterback of an NFL team. I wanted to be the quarterback of a top 10 team playing in the national title game. And we have a chance to do that, and this is a dream come true for me.
Well, now streaming exclusively on ESPN Plus. And during the quarter break here, Roddy, that is a senior in his final college game talking to not only his fellow seniors, but next year's Miami team in Shaq Quarterman.
And Shaq Quarterman is a guy who started for 4 years for Miami. He's given so much for this program, and the results haven't been there on the field. So his decision to play in this game alone was a mature decision, but getting his team up to start the fourth.
Smith on the keeper. And he'll pick up almost 5. Quarterman in on the hit. Jonathan Ford also involved.
His helmet came off. Jamar Smith did, so.
That might mean we see Aaron Allen, who started the 2 ball games at Marshall and at UAB. And here comes the redshirt freshman from Missouri City, Texas. In at the quarterback spot. Allen, by the way, threw for 173 yards and 2 scores, but a loss to the Blazers. That's Harris in motion. And we got early movement. That's Holly starting too fast. That'll cost the Bulldogs.
False start, number 73. Offense.
That'll bring Smith back in the ballgame, by the way.
I think that's what I think, too.
He started back in, but they pulled him back. Yep.
Like the effort, Jamar.
Yeah.
Catch him napping, right, Ewood?
I like that effort. I also like the first down call they made, too. Greg Rousseau has been burning Stallworth on the edge, so they used his pass rush against him and ran that QB draw right inside of him.
This is Henderson trying to find a seam off the left. Just a couple of yards there, and now Jamar Smith will come back in for Aaron Allen.
And the interesting thing here on this third down is going to be how aggressive is Louisiana Tech? It would be a long field goal, 45 yards from where they are right now.
Right.
But do you risk dropping back to pass and have Greg Rousseau and Scott Patchen coming off the edge at you and risk a sack?
Bailey Hale, by the way, he's hit 15 of his last 16, including a 50-yarder at Southern Miss this year. Here's Smith. Wants the throw and caught. Grabbed by Graham. Second big catch for Isaiah Graham in the half. And this one a first down just inside the 20 of Miami.
With Miami playing the amount of press coverage they have, these receivers are going to have to come up with some big plays, making contested catches. And they have done just enough of that in the second half to move the chains.
Tough day for Al Blades. He's had some good cover, Roddy, but Louisiana Tech's made some great catches in traffic.
Well, that's the thing about being a corner. I mean, you can play great for 80 snaps out of 82, and if they beat you on two of them, those are the two that you're going to remember. It's really been a successful game for this Miami defense, and the defensive backs in particular. They played some great press covers. They've allowed the rush to get to Jamar Smith. But, I mean, every once in a while, a receiver's just going to make a play on you.
First red zone appearance for either school comes here in the early stages of the fourth. You see the total offense in the second half. Under 100 for the Bulldogs and just 20 for Miami. Smith trying to get for Hebert on the near side, and Romeo Finley has come up hobbling.
Romeo Finley,
that's Griffin,
right,
Hebert.
That's right in front of me, and his calf appears to be locked up on him. Just a cramp situation. He should be able to get back in this ball game.
All right.
Griffin Hebert has been such a target for them and weapon for them in the red zone. It's a really nice job of Finley in coverage there. And now you're going to get to Corey Couch, the freshman from Fort Lauderdale, in that spot.
Intercepted! And working his way back upfield, Gilbert Frierson. And Frierson at the 30 and down to the 28-yard line. That ball got juggled around, and then it looked like Couch picked it up. Did Frierson hand the ball off, Roddy?
I think he did. He was looking for the lateral, and it looked like he handed that ball off. First off, it's a great read by Frierson to be able to pick this ball off on the screen. He makes Jamar Smith, breaks that tackle, then cuts back. And then
oh, my gosh, he did.
Tosses it.
And I love that. I love that. As much as your offense has struggled today,
oh,
as a defender,
goodness,
you're thinking, we need to put the ball in the end zone ourselves. Let's do whatever we can to get that done.
51-yard return on the interception. And the ball at the 29 of Louisiana Tech. And Miami has been given unbelievable field position for an offense that has struggled all day. And here is Nikosi Perry, the third Miami quarterback of the day.
And what a turn of events for Louisiana Tech, who was in field goal range with an opportunity to extend this lead to a double-digit lead. An interception by Miami. Let's see if it sparks this team. Between the interception, the great return, the new quarterback, maybe that's the right combination of spark that this Miami offense needed.
Perry started 6 ball games during the year. He's 4-2. He threw for 427 and 4 touchdowns after Williams got off to a horrible start against Virginia Tech earlier this year.
During the return, there was a backwards pass. Previous play is under further review.
So the play is under review to Corey Couch. Got the turnover chain. So did Gilbert Frierson. We get a break.
And after review, they called this an illegal forward pass with Gilbert Frierson tossing it to Corey Couch. That ball was caught ahead of where Frierson left it or released it. So it's going to come back. Miami's going to have the ball right at the 50-yard line now.
And Nikosi Perry is still going to take the snap,
yeah,
by the way.
Didn't change their mind in the break.
Third different Miami quarterback today. We saw one possession of Tate Martell. Eric Wood reporting early second half that Martell was injured. They were going to try and get him back in the game, but weren't sure if he'd be able to go. Jaren Williams is quarterback all but those possessions, this one and the Martell one. And now all of a sudden, here's Nikosi Perry. Quick throw to the perimeter. This is Osborne, and he will reach for about 4 yards. And the perimeter tackle from Aaron Roberson.
You got to think there's big fourth quarter implications for Nikosi Perry here. This is a guy who is patient this year. He has a winning record as a starter for the Hurricanes this year. And this is a guy, if he plays well in this fourth quarter, he could set himself up to be the starter come spring football time.
Well, Manny Diaz told us this is the 2020 quarterback evaluation, right?
Yeah, and it's going to continue into the spring. The question is, on day one, who's going to take those first snaps?
And a handoff to Harris, trying to bounce it outside. And a big play by Taylor, the linebacker. Connor Taylor, K Kaysville, Utah. Went to Snow College, transferred to Ruston. But don't let the look fool you. The guy can go.
I think the look tells you that the guy can go. He's been all over the field today. Nice job of fighting off of a block. He's right in the heart of that Louisiana Tech defense. Pitched a shutout so far. And this one will likely see the first real drop-back pass for Nikosi Perry on this 3rd-and-7.
Robert Burns is coming to the ball game. Bulldogs show pressure. Perry cuts it loose, near side. Ball caught, first down, Mark Pope. Good-looking throw from Perry.
Confident, on time. Louisiana Tech sent a pressure. Miami had enough to pick it up, and Perry was able to stand and deliver. Really nice throw from the quarterback.
So first and 10, Miami at the Louisiana Tech 35. 10.5 minutes to go in the ball game here in Shreveport. Bulldogs second quarter touchdown, still the only points of the ball game. Perry wants to cut it loose again. Fails to the right side and dumps it out in space. Flag down on the play. On the throw to Burns. In the neighborhood of a hold against Miami. Scott Campbell from the Big 12, the referee here in Shreveport.
In the backfield, offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Just a 5-yard penalty. Don't forget, coming up tonight, following our coverage here from Shreveport, we'll send you to Detroit. The Quick Lane Bowl features Pat Narduzzi in Pittsburgh against Eastern Michigan. Mike Corey, Rini Ngolia, Allison Williams standing by for coverage from the Motor City. Got an interesting matchup there with the Panther defense against the Eagles offensive unit. After the penalty, straight ahead goes Burns again. And the redshirt sophomore from Gulliver Prep in Miami picks up a yard, maybe.
One of the things that Louisiana Tech's going to have to be aware of is Nikosi Perry's ability to run the football. They've kind of gotten the full gamut today. When you look at what Jaren Williams brings. Yeah, true. The true pocket passer.
Right.
You get Tate Martell, who's a dynamic runner. Now you get the blend of the two. Nikosi Perry can certainly throw the ball a little bit, a better runner than Williams. So we'll see how much Miami wants to do of that with him in the game.
Perry on a play fake. Pressure coming and made the guy miss. Now going to put it up. Was he far enough out to be considered out of the tackle box? Officials are huddling. Snead pressured Perry.
Potential grounding. The quarterback was out of the pocket.
Partisan
the ball
Bulldog
crossed the line
fans,
of scrimmage. Third down.
Who came over from Ruston. And points here in Northwest Louisiana not happy at all with the flag not being thrown there.
We've got a great shot of it. Perry drops back to pass. Again, Louisiana Tech able to get pressure. And yeah, he's outside of the tackle box. Clearly no foul for intentional grounding.
Third and 14. Perry dances again. Throws and Harley the catch, but out of bounds. Mike Harley tried to corral it around the 17.
This is an interesting down and distance. It looks like Manny Diaz is going to send the punt team out on the field, but I would not have blamed him for going on it the way his defense is playing. Mike Harley clearly out of bounds on that catch. But the pressure's been getting to these Miami quarterbacks all night. They've done a pretty good job of making guys miss in the backfield to be able to throw the ball. Not enough completions ultimately.
CJ Powell waits on Lou Headley's punt. We've got an Independence Bowl record for punts here tonight. Powell gonna let it hit. It checks up out of bounds around the 11 of Louisiana Tech. 9 minutes, 3 seconds to play in the walk-ons. Independence Bowl, 7-0 Louisiana Tech.
The Walk-Ons Independence Bowl, brought to you by Walk-Ons Bistro and Bar. Game day with a taste of Louisiana. And Ticket Smarter, a smarter way to buy tickets to live events.
Oh, those last two, Roddy Jones saw, right?
Come on,
Duke
man.
And Florida State. winners of the Independence Bowl presented by Walk-Ons. We welcome you back to Independence Stadium in Shreveport with Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, our great crew, Chris Damiani, our producer.
It's one of the best trophies in the entire country, that Independence Bowl trophy.
Looks like it might be heavy, too, Ewood. Be
I
careful,
know. Luckily,
son.
We got members from the Air Force down here to present it because that sucker is absolutely heavy. me and former teammate of mine, Lou Grosewinner, Art Carmody, the chairman, we were both struggling to carry it earlier.
Yeah, I bet you were. Tom, you went to 3 Pro Bowls. You can carry anything. Saying, you can cross any highway and carry any bowl trophy.
I find it hard to believe that Ewood had a tough time carrying it.
Maybe Art was struggling.
There you go.
Art's handled all the hospitality for these two teams who've had outstanding time here in the Shreveport-Bossier City area. So after the punt, Louisiana Tech goes from its 10, and I'm going to go back to something you said earlier about a second score, Roddy.
If Louisiana Tech had been able to get a field goal in the last drive before the interception, you got to feel like this game's out of reach at 2 scores for this Miami offense, being that they haven't scored a point yet, and they haven't really had any consistency on offense. So if Louisiana Tech can somehow hit a big play, drive down, get in the red zone, and kick a field goal and get this to a 2-score game,
yeah,
that might be night's over.
You see what's on tap in the next about 18 hours, if you will. Detroit, Annapolis, and New York. All teed up for you.
A few days for the ACC in terms of bowl games, capping off with Clemson on Saturday night.
Second down after the Henderson carry. One more time, Justin Henderson will reach the 15. Third and 5 facing the Bulldogs. Sam Brooks the tackle. Todd Fitch was very candid with us, the offensive coordinator for Louisiana Tech. He knew Miami might be the best defensive outfit they were going to see all year. They have been patient in their approach here today. Now Smith to make the throw, and there it is. Slant and catch across the middle, and it's Malik Stanley who had a big one to start the ball game and gets a big third down conversion here.
And Louisiana Tech has found success going to the single receiver side against Al Blades. Receivers winning in coverage that time. You have Stanley able to get open off press, able to create some separation. A really nice completion and conversion on third down.
You see the 3 catches for 75 yards today for Malik Stanley. 5th-year senior from Topeka, Kansas. Started his college career at South Alabama. And then Harris on the end around. And now marker has been thrown as Harris was tagged late on the play. And that might be a little more to the till on Miami.
Looks like it's going to be on Sam Brooks, the linebacker that's starting in place of Michael Pinkney.
After the play was over, personal foul, late hit out of bounds, number 6, defense. A penalty from the dead ball spot, automatic.
7.5 down. Plus to go. Another look.
And you see Brooks on that replay just throws him to the ground. There's no reason for that, and not only that, like, I get guys playing aggressive, but your defense is playing solo. This is a defensive football game. You know it's going to come down to getting stop after stop after stop. You can't give away 15 free yards.
Working towards 7 minutes to go, 1st and 10 at midfield, and Henderson just bangs away for a couple more. And honestly, Roddy, if I'm Louisiana Tech, that's enough to get it going. And because Miami's struggled enough to get anything built offensively. And you're down to 1 timeout.
Yeah, and you're looking at getting 15 more yards before you're in field goal range for Bailey Hale.
Oh, you're not. If you're Skip Holtz, you don't even have to try the field goal.
Yeah.
You just pin them deep and go for it.
Point. You take the air out of the football, right. Drive down, take some time off the clock, and you're exactly right there. I mean, what Miami's shown on offense.
Right.
Time. If you can drain time off this clock, Miami's going to have a tough, tough time.
Here's Henderson again, just going left side. And it'll be 3rd down and about 4, maybe 3.5.
Roddy, did I just hear Wes pulling for another punt in this game?
No, I knew Wes
was secretly enjoying this game more than he should.
Hey, it's the season of gluttony. He's saying all the punts that you can give me, I'll take them.
Hey, but to your point, it back to the Sam Brooks personal foul. This is a Miami defense that has gotten frustrated this season. And we talked to Manny Diaz after the FIU game, prior to the Duke game, and he said at some point your defense, after getting a stop after stop and the offense not being able to capitalize, at some point they just become so frustrated, and you saw it on the play from Sam Brooks on the personal foul.
Big play here, third down. Smith going to throw, and incomplete. Threw it in the neighborhood, it looked like, of Israel Tucker, but it's fourth down.
Louisiana Tech got a little fortunate on the play before. The ball popped out. They were able to jump on it. Here they tried to set up the screen. So Jamar Smith is arguing his case that there was an eligible receiver in the neighborhood.
Number 22 was in the area, fourth down.
So it is fourth down. There'll be no flag for the intention. To be honest with you, a little surprised they ran through the ball on third down and three.
Yeah, I am a little bit as well. Particularly with the success that they've had in the run game. And Jamar Smith running the football has been something that they've had some success with as well. But opting to go for the screen, try and catch Miami in a blitz, not able to convert.
Farlow punts it away. And it will go to the end zone, about 3-4 yards deep, with 5.5 minutes to play in the Walk-On's Independence Bowl. Louisiana Tech 7, Miami nothing.
Let's take a look back with our Expedia drive recap. It's actually two drives, really. Miami throws an interception. Louisiana Tech then gets the ball back and has a great drive going. They're able to convert on some third downs with some tight coverage, great catches in traffic, but throws an interception of their own when inside the red zone, and that's the reason we've only had one scoring drive during this game, a 13-play, 91-yard drive earlier in the game from Louisiana Tech. Has amounted to the only points in this 7-0 ball game.
And now here is Miami with Nikosi Perry back at the quarterback spot. Miami has played all three quarterbacks, Jaren Williams, Tate Martell, for a series in the first half. And now the second throw of the day. Perry and Mallory got it knocked loose, and it is ruled a fumble and a recovery for the Bulldogs. The tight end, Will Mallory, headed about the 40-yard line on a throw from Perry. And at least on the field for the time being, it's ruled a turnover and awarded to the Bulldogs. Tristan Allen on the recovery.
And Wes, we'll get a look at this, but to me, in real time, I'm not sure he had possession for long enough for this to be considered a fumble. When you make these decisions, you have to watch them in real speed. We can't slow it down to slow motion to be able to make that decision, because that's not what the replay officials do. And in real time, I'm not sure he had the ball long enough for it to be considered possession and a fumble. My initial reaction was that it was incomplete, but the referees ruled it a fumble on the field, so they can go back and, upon review, overturn it if necessary.
Zach Hannibal and Daryl Lewis colliding on Mallory to force the ball out of there. And Scott Campbell, the referee, indeed, is going to go to the headset.
It's big that they called it a fumble and recovery on the field. That always helps if you're a Louisiana Tech fan in this situation. At times, they'll uphold that. And it'll be interesting here to see if they consider it a football move when he's bringing it down. And is the football moving as he's bringing the ball down to his body? Because he is taking a couple steps during that process, in Durati's point. A very fast process. But he is bringing it down. It'll be interesting to see if they consider that possession while he's making what may be called a football move.
Well, I don't know that he tucks it away, for starters.
Well, the thing is, we've shown all these replays in slow motion. You have to judge this right in real speed. The second thing is, when you see it in real speed, does he have enough time to make an act common to the game? Tucking the football, being able to make a move, bracing himself. And in real speed, I'm just not sure that he was able to do that. Now, Eric brought up another good point. Is the ball moving during this whole process? Because the ball's moving and he never has full control, but the whole point's moved.
Right. That's kind of where I am on this, but let's see what Scott Campbell has come up with on this process. And now, the referee out of the Big 12 has moved behind the Miami benches here. So they're going to a telephone because they've lost communication with the replay booth upstairs. So a landline of sorts behind the Miami bench.
We've had some technical difficulty ourselves during this game, so the referees are not immune to it as well. So get another look. And Will Mallory is such a big part of this offense. I like them going to him early up the seam on this drive. And the fact that they're trying to get him involved is a good sign for this Miami offense. I still think that there's just not enough there to consider that a football or an act common to the game once he makes that catch. And the ball is moving. I don't see a securing of the football either.
And to your point about Mallory, the strength of this Miami offense is their tight ends, Brevin Jordan, but he is out of this game. First team all ACC, Will Mallory. They're probably their next best player on offense, in my opinion, especially with DJ Dallas out of this game. They have to get them involved. Also, what we haven't seen them get back to is the screen game.
Crowd one on the screen game, Eric.
Crowd is already booing because the ball is being set for play at the 20. Scott Campbell, I think, will tell us
after
it's incomplete.
Review, it was an incomplete pass. It's going to be second and 10 from the 20-yard line. Will the game clock operator please reset the game clock to 5 minutes, 24 seconds. 5:24.
So there's the maintenance on the ball game.
And it was a good point that Eric just made about the screen game. Miami really hasn't gone back to that, and that's something that they used a lot with Brevin Jordan when he was in, but
right.
Let's remember, Brevin Jordan out on this offense, Navon Donaldson, the starting left guard, out as well, DJ Dallas out, and Jeff Thomas out. Three of those guys due to injury, and Thomas due to preparing for the NFL draft. So these are significant contributors that are not playing on offense for Miami.
So with 5:24 to go, Miami has its second and 10. And Nikosi Perry on in relief of Jaron Williams and, I guess, to a degree, Tate Martell, right?
It's the third reliever in.
Yep. Miami's only got one timeout left. And here's Perry. Back across the middle. Mallory catches that one. Falls forward for the first down to the 32. Colin Scott, the linebacker, right there on the 12-yard play for Louisiana Tech.
It was a really nice job of Mallory working in between those two linebackers. He kind of went to Scott, pivoted back away from him, and Perry was able to deliver the ball for a nice first down. I really like them going to Mallory. He's been their most consistent throughout the season in terms of being a target, at least late in the year.
That's Harley in motion. Play fake by Perry. Going to sling it in the seam and off the fingertips of the tight end, Mallory again. Well, they've got an 85 in the act now. Mallory is a full piece of the throw game here in the final 5 minutes.
Well, someone got on headset and said, hey, guys, let's go to the tight end. He's a matchup nightmare, 6'5", runs well in Will Mallory. Nikosi Perry just not able to put that one quite on target. But they were trying to slip him out after faking blocking, slip him up the sideline on a little wheel route.
Second in the full 10 for Perry. Now, dances in the pocket. Perry picks up almost 4 and took a big lick. And that hit was delivered by Tristan Allen, the redshirt sophomore. Wow.
The Miami sideline was clamoring for a penalty for targeting, and I'm not sure they don't have an argument there.
Wow.
And that is forceful contact to the head or neck area. He's a runner, so he's not a defenseless player, but does he strike with the crown of the helmet? An attack with the crown of the helmet is targeting no matter what.
They're going to blow the whistle.
Looks like it's been stopped.
Yep. Manny Diaz was really
play is under further review.
Hot about it. Now remember, Colin Scott was ejected from their final regular season game in the last minute because of a targeting call against the Roadrunners of then head coach Frank Wilson at Texas San Antonio. And here now, a booth initiated review against Tristan Allen.
And we thought this is what we might get. And it is certainly helmet to helmet. With Perry being a runner going down to the ground, I believe that he's going to be a defenseless player there, but the question is contact made with the crown of the helmet? It's not illegal to make contact with the helmet, but you have to have an attack with the crown of the helmet. And this is about as gray area as you can get in terms of the definition of crown of the helmet.
Yeah, I was going to say, as he's going down to the ground, that's a really tough play for Allen to try and come in and make and not get a targeting or not make contact with the head. The key is not lowering your helmet, and he does ever so slightly, but to me, a lot more contact with the face mask than a true crown of the helmet hit.
I remember still sitting in that clinic this summer, though, and talking about where the crown of the helmet was, where it starts, where it ends.
And look, these ultimately are judgment decisions.
Sure.
There's going to be a couple of questions here. Is there an indicator of targeting? That's an attack from a launch, a lowering of the helmet, from a crouch. And even that's a gray area there. He's going down for the tackle, as Eric said, lowers the head ever so slightly and then makes contact with the helmet of Nikosi Perry. This is about as gray as I think you can be, because what is considered the crown? Did he make contact with the crown? And is it enough to throw a young man out of the game for it?
Right. And another review for Scott Campbell with the replay booth here at Independence Stadium.
The other thing about sitting in that room in the referees clinic over the summer, Wes, is when we did that, on a call like this, there would likely be some dissension even in that room.
Right.
There were disagreements on catch, no catch, on everything. There was a little bit of disagreement either way.
Here's referee Campbell.
After review, it was determined there was a personal foul targeting number 43, defense. 15-yard penalty from the dead ball spot, automatic first down. Number 43 has been disqualified.
And you see Tristan Allen. Now remember, Allen getting reps today because Willie Baker, honorable mention All-Conference USA out of New Roads, Louisiana, is injured. He led the Bulldogs in tackles for loss with 10 on the year. We've seen Ezekiel Barnett play opposite James Jackson, now Tristan Allen. And we'll see where they get more in the depth here.
And that's frustrating for Louisiana Tech, but you can't disagree with that call. The question was just, was there enough there to be able to make the call? And the referees determined that there was.
Low snap to Perry. Nikosi thought about it. Spins from trouble. Flag down on the play, and Perry will then draw a face mask from Barnett. So we'll have all setting penalties. I think first flag was a hold on Miami, and the second, I think, is a face mask against Louisiana Tech.
Ended up with four flags on the field between the referees who were observing the play. So we'll see what we end up getting here. I think I agree with you.
It's a buffet for Scott Campbell and his crew. And you can tell that Ezekiel Barnett is a very interested attendant to the conversation.
There are fouls by both teams. Holding, number 65, offense. Personal foul, face mask, number 46, defense. Those fouls will offset. Replay, first down.
So there you have it. First of all, you get Gaynor on the hold.
The jersey being pulled, and then when Nikosi Perry tries to escape the tackle, you get the face mask. So it's been a little bit of a tough couple of plays for Nikosi Perry in the head area. It's the targeting, first of all, and then you get the face mask on the next play.
Three receivers and a tight end for another first and 10 crack. Perry tries to spin it, and it's picked. And that is Aaron Roberson. First interception of the season for Roberson. And with 3:22 to go, is that going to be enough to close the door on the 10th win of the year for Louisiana Tech?
Well, Aaron Roberson just sat on that route, dropped to about 10 yards, and was watching Nikosi Perry the entire way. When Perry goes to the out, Roberson jumps the route, is able to intercept it. Louisiana Tech's got the ball.
Well, we come down to the final 3:22 here from Shreveport, the Walk-On's Independence Bowl. Don't forget to tune into the ESPN app for the post-game trophy ceremony presented by Capital One immediately following the game.
Hosted by Eric Wood.
That's right. He would.
Hosted but not hoisted.
I think it's the
we
only
we're going to let the military members that it.
Clarity always important in any work, in any ceremony.
Only post-game trophy ceremony is hosted by a Pro Bowler.
That's right. Three-time Pro Bowler.
There you go.
Is that more of a testament to me, or is that a dig?
No.
We now have our
testament. We got one up on everybody else.
Yeah. Here's Jamar Smith. He's going to keep it, try to slide upfield. Gets a couple before he's pushed back. And now Manny Diaz will use a timeout on the Scott Patchen tackle.
His last timeout. Let's not forget, Miami used a timeout on the first third down of the second half and then the last play of the third quarter.
Don't forget the college football playoff semifinals coming up on Saturday on ESPN and the ESPN app. Heisman winner Joe Burrow, number one LSU, meet number four Oklahoma at Mercedes-Benz Stadium in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl at 4 o'clock Eastern, 1 Pacific. And then out to the desert, number two Ohio State and number three Clemson in the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl. Winners play for the national championship of college football on Monday, January 13th.
That's some dudes right there.
Some players on the screen right there, young man.
Justin Fields, Trevor Lawrence, the two quarterbacks. You got Travis Etienne, the player of the year in the ACC.
Chase Young. Isaiah Simmons.
Yeah, Isaiah Simmons, and I think that was Jeff Okuda as well.
By the way, we have offered some things for you.
Man.
Roddy and I tend to be in the same camp. He would. Wants to go with Coach O.
We need it
just
drama.
In case he runs into folks in Northwest Louisiana tonight, Roddy. He can say, I picked you to win the whole thing.
I knew where we were going for our bowl game. And I also thought our crew is going to get hammered with homer predictions if the ACC crew calling the bowl game for ESPN all had Clemson winning it all.
I understand.
Well, and the thing is, you know, there's not been a lot of respect given to Oklahoma in particular, but there's a lot of people on the Clemson bandwagon. So if I'm Ohio State and Oklahoma, every time I see one of those come up, I'm printing it out, putting it on the wall for motivation.
That's Harris in motion. Here is Smith handing to Harris. Around the perimeter, Smoke Harris will go out of bounds inside the 40 at the 37. And that will stop the clock with 3:09 to play on a 16-yard sweep.
Really the first time they've gotten loose on one of these, the speed sweep. But Smoke Harris, an absolute burner around the corner. Able to seal the edge, and Louisiana Tech with a first down. Now Miami can't stop the clock, so Louisiana Tech's just going to run the football and drain it down. And even if Miami were to stop them on three downs and force a punt, I mean, you're looking at right around a minute left as the clock's going to run here. Remember, the clock doesn't stop on an out-of-bounds play until under 2 minutes.
And Louisiana Tech in Miami, they've already set an Independence Bowl record for punts, are now also looking at the first shutout in the 34-year history of this game. Rousseau, the tackle. I say 44-year history of this game. You're exactly right, sir. College football scoreboard, Zubin Mahinty, Trevor Maddich. And then Mike Corey, Rini Angolia, and Allison Williams waiting at Ford Field tonight.
How about that guy? He's all over it.
A little work at home.
Absolutely.
Pays off. You got yourself on television. Congratulations, and we wish you all the best during the holiday season.
Thanks for making our job easier.
That's exactly right. Save our producer, Chris Damiani, a promo. Second down, and the clock approaching 2 minutes. The touchdown to Tucker is the only score in this ball game until now. Jamar Smith will slide down at the 5. And you know what Jamar Smith just did? Run out the clock.
Absolutely. Had he gone in and scored the touchdown, Miami has an opportunity to get the ball back. And so often we talk about the right decision to make. I'm not sure it would really matter. Two scores isn't going to, Miami's not going to be able to get that. But either way, now Louisiana Tech's going to finish this game with a couple of knees. Miami can't stop the clock. Congratulations to that man, Skip Holtz. 10 wins for the first time as an FBS program. His sixth consecutive bowl win. What a job by Skip Holtz. And he talked to us before the game. This is kind of the season that could have, would have been.
Yep.
It's a team that was 8-1 with an opportunity to go to the Conference USA Championship game. They suspend Adrian Hardy, Jamar Smith, who gets in the end zone here, and they lose those games, but able to cap it off.
So Smith does score in his final collegiate game. Pushes across. The second touchdown on an 8-yard run with 75 seconds left.
It's been a little bit of a tough day for Jamar Smith on the whole. Has not found the rhythm throwing the football. He's going to have to give a big ups, big props to his defense for keeping them in this football game. But the fifth-year senior able to get in the end zone in his final collegiate game.
So here's Bailey Hale. And the point after makes it 14-0. And 10 wins for the first time in 35 years for the Bulldogs of Louisiana Tech. Wow.
This is a really good football team that Skip Holtz has put together. And you could tell there was a little bit of what coulda, woulda, shoulda. Had Jamar Smith and Adrian Hardy not been suspended, had they not had those violation of team rules, we very well could have seen them versus FAU in the Conference USA Championship game, and then who knows, but the taste that is going to be left for this team and the legacy that this senior-laden team is going to leave at Louisiana Tech is going to last forever. The first 10-win team as an FBS program. And that guy's been a big reason for it all year. Conference USA Offensive Player of the Year, Jamar Smith.
25th win and his 38th career start, Roddy.
Pretty good.
10-1 this year.
Pretty good.
Yep. And with a minute 15 left to play, Miami will get the ball back out of timeouts. Osborne and Harley are deep for the Canes, who are going to finish at 6-7 and a losing record for the first time since 2014. And they will fall on the football. Mike Parrott, the fullback, at the 21. Don't forget SportsCenter tonight after the Quick Lane Bowl from Detroit. Michael Eaves and Nabil Kareem. Potential return of Luka Doncic in the Mavs Spurs game, plus what motivates Ohio State defensive end Chase Young. And how has Carson Wentz turned it around? SportsCenter after Pittsburgh, Eastern Michigan on ESPN and the ESPN app. We're ready to send you to Detroit here in a few minutes for the Quick Lane game between Pittsburgh and Eastern Michigan.
I have a feeling there's going to be more points scored in that game, but less punts.
Hey, Coach Holtz is on high alert. He is moving up and down the sideline very fast. I think he's trying to avoid the inevitable Gatorade bath.
Yep.
That his. Hopefully it's a couple seniors, too, because they deserve it. What a career this senior class has had at Louisiana Tech.
Yeah, one of the most successful four-year classes in the Ruston campus history, and that one almost picked again by Roberson. Time for tonight's Capital One Player of the Game. How about linebacker Connor Taylor, senior from Kaysville, Utah. 7 tackles. 1.5 behind the line of pass breakup. Part of shutting out Miami for the first time since Clemson did it.
He has been all over the field. Been the heart and soul of this defense. Really all year, but certainly today. And what a job that this defense has done. You can't say enough about their performance because they're often sputtered for much of the game. It's a defensive contest.
Perry will escape the pocket, slide down shy of the first down. That shutout by Clemson occurred in 2015, Roddy. And Miami has 54 seconds to try and scratch here in Shreveport. And Mallory will get out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Well, we told you at the front of the broadcast that Tim Reynolds of the Associated Press in the Miami area reporting that there is an understanding that today could potentially be Dan Enos' last game as the offensive coordinator. Miami did not offer a comment to that tweet from Tim Reynolds. And it will be an interesting offseason for Manny Diaz.
This was a team that was expected. As you see the Gatorade bath making its way for Skip Holtz. This is a team that was expected to contend at the top of the Coastal Division in the ACC to end up with a losing season with losses to FIU, Louisiana Tech, Georgia Tech, and Duke. It's not a good look for a Miami program with the amount of talent that they have.
Perry hanging it high down the field. And it is incomplete. Yep.
That was a little bit of, I got it, and then nobody's got it.
Yep. We got a couple of Bulldogs down and slow to their feet. Legarius Sneed and Darrell Lewis both deep with Avery Aaron Roberson, who has already got an interception to his credit tonight. And Skip Holtz, he is avoiding.
And good for him. And talking to people around the Louisiana Tech program about what this program has become, you know, they'll point to the Derek Dooley era and say it started then continued under Sonny Dykes. And Skip Holtz has certainly taken it to the next level. And this is a true program that has done it through development. And the question for them next year is going to be, can they replace all of the production that's leaving on the offensive line, quarterback, really all over this team? Skip Holtz is going to worry about that down the line. Right now he's worrying about avoiding the Gatorade back.
Yep. Throw across the middle, Mallory the catch.
And selfishly, I hope they catch him now, because if they get me while I'm doing my post-game interview with him, I am not going to be happy, because that's going to ruin my night out with you guys tonight.
Here's Perry on what likely is the final play of the game. Nicosi going to sail it for the end zone in the corner. And it's broken up incomplete. The ball game is over. Skip Holtz gets the shower. Louisiana Tech wins their 10th. We've got our first shutout in the history of the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl, and it's done by the Bulldogs from Ruston, who beat Miami by a final of 14-0.
And this defense was firing on all cylinders during this game. It's a fantastic performance by them. The offense did enough, obviously, with one score in meaningful time and then one score to kind of put it way out of reach. But the story of this game is the defense. They were fantastic against the Miami offense that struggled really most of the second half of the season. But all credit goes to these guys, who will always be able to say, we beat the U in the Independence Bowl.
Yep. 10 wins for the first time in 35 years for Louisiana Tech. Best four-year stretch in recent memories. And here is Skip Holtz with Eric Wood.
Coach, how does it feel to be the 2019 Independence Bowl champs?
Awesome feeling. Just really proud of these players and where they came in here and competed in this game in defense. Oh, my gosh. Couldn't be more proud of them. And the job Bob Diaco and the whole defensive staff did, and the way those guys competed. Wasn't always pretty on offense, but at the end, when we had to make something happen, they're a really good defensive football team. And up front, we were able to crease a couple seams and break something free and put that final touchdown on the board. We gave us a little bit of security, but really proud of this football team. This great place, great people, but we couldn't be more proud of these 23 seniors and what they've been able to accomplish this season.
Yeah, you talk about your seniors. They leave the winningest class, tied for the winningest class in school history, and you get to coach them throughout their whole career. How special is that?
You know, pretty special when you look at what these guys have done, and for the sixth bowl game in a row, six bowl wins in a row. Like I said, it's just a real tribute to these guys. I haven't made a block or a tackle. These guys are out there, and they played their tails out on the field. They're so close together, and there's such a bond and such a brotherhood with each other, and just couldn't be more proud of the way they came out here and competed tonight. Great leadership. The celebration begins here in Shreveport. And thank you to so many of the fans, the people that came out like a home game, this crowd. It was awesome. Thank you to the people of Shreveport, the Independence Bowl walk-ons. But it all started with Rudy's coin toss when Louisiana Tech won it.
Congrats, Coach.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right, Eric. Thanks very much. 14-0, Louisiana Tech is the winner. Stay tuned. Plenty more to come, including Detroit and the Quick Lane Bowl. The Bulldogs get their 10th win. Great to be with Roddy Jones, Eric Wood, our producer Chris Damiani, our director Chuck Ciccarillo. Stay tuned now. College football scoreboard. Zubin Mehenti and Trevor Manage coming up. From Independence Stadium in Northwest Louisiana, West Durham reminding you our final, Louisiana Tech 14, Miami nothing. Off to Zubin and Trevor. The festivities down on the field are about to begin, but first, this message. Promise that you'll never find another like me.
With the Capital One Saver Card, you earn 4% cash back on dining and 4% on entertainment. So when you go out, you cash in. What's in your wallet?
Attention to the field. Louisiana Tech wins 14-0 over Miami to capture the Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. Let's take a look at tonight's Capital One rewarding performance. And it's the linebacker, Connor Taylor, Roddy.
He was fantastic for a defense that was lights out during this game. Seven tackles for the long-haired linebacker, one and a half sacks. And really, he was the heart and soul. Sideline to sideline performance. He did it blitzing. He did it staying back. This defense, to be able to shut out a team with the talent of Miami, you can't say enough about the performance of this whole crew. If we could give this to the whole crew, we would. But Connor Taylor was the biggest reason they had success.
Yep. Taylor and Ezekiel Barnett, they did a nice job following the loss of Willie Baker. Let's go downstairs, and the chairman of the bowl is Art Carmody.
On behalf of these players who played an unbelievable game and put their heart out on that field, the administration and the great fans of Louisiana Tech, we gladly accept.
Coach, let me grab you for a second. How does it feel in front of this crowd, this home crowd for you guys today? How does it feel to walk out a champion?
Just so proud of these players, these seniors, what they were able to accomplish here at Louisiana Tech during their time here. The way they competed in this bowl game, I just couldn't be more proud of these players. But for the university, six in a row, at this point, six in a row. Just thank you to Dr. Geis, the leadership that he provides, Tommy, and our great fans. It's been an awesome ride.
One more time, please tell me about how special it is for these seniors to leave the winningest class in Louisiana Tech history.
Well, I mean, ever since we have gone Division I, these seniors came in here 5 years ago, and they have made a bond, a commitment, a brotherhood that will be here for a long, long time. And I'm just really proud of these seniors, the adversity that they've overcome, what they've been able to accomplish here, and the way that they've represented this university.
Thanks, Coach.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you.
This year's most outstanding offensive player is Justin Henderson. Justin, how important against a defense like Miami was it to establish the run here today?
It was very important. The run game opened up the pass game. So we worked on that at practice and stuff. And it came today, and the linemen did a heck of a job today, and we got the job done.
As a former offensive lineman, I love you giving the crowd out to your guys up front. Congratulations. This year's most outstanding defensive player goes to Connor Taylor. An absolutely dominant performance by this defense today. What was the key in shutting out this Hurricanes offense?
I mean, just playing the team defense that we practice every day and relying on each other and going out there and giving 100% effort, 100% focus. And that's what we came to do today.
Congratulations.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
And now, to make a special presentation is Walk-On's founder and CEO, Brandon Landry.
First of all, guys, congrats on the win. You guys deserve it. As a walk-on, as a former walk-on, you know about being a walk-on is playing for the true love of the game, right? You play for the name on the front of the jersey, not on the back. This year, the walk-on of the game, Darryl Lewis, right here. Where you at, Rudy? I got America's walk-on, Rudy Rudiker, that's going to present you with the trophy. Rudy's right here. And we're also going to donate $5,000 to your general scholarship fund in Louisiana Tech in your name, Darryl. Congrats, man.
And that'll do it from the 2019 Walk-Ons Independence Bowl. Congratulations, Louisiana Tech Bulldogs.